Hello and welcome back to Everlasting Summer. Now this time I am going to go through ALISA's route. I'm going to skip around and primarily show what I find interesting, which might end up in a really long episode because it is still a full route, but I want to not spend multiple weeks on each route basically. I'd like to go through everything, but I'd like to show all the interesting stuff too, especially since I'm doing this anyways. I was originally really not going to show anything, but I sort of just got to a point where I was like, yeah, I might as well just show all of it, you know. Also, fair warning, I am sort of more congested than I have been in quite some time, and I'm working through settling that, but it, for me, it never goes away quickly enough. Never. Okay. So yes, if you want to see the rest of it, like I said in my last video for Yana's End, either the parts that I don't show, this is a free game, you can go through and try it yourself, or you can go back for the parts I have shown in previous ends, mainly the first whole show everything route I did, which was Slavia's route. If you want to see all that, then you can go back to episode 1, which there'll be a playlist somewhere on my channel, basically, if you want to do that. So, other than that, I'm going to move forward with this, and if you don't want to get spoiled on any little thing because I'm jumping around, I do suggest going and figuring out the other stuff first. So this is the point when we're making a bet with ALISA or not. So, have you made a decision? I'm going to answer, yep. We've already seen this part, but I've never bet with ALISA before. I may regret it 100 times. Fine. Do it. She smiled. But if I win? Yeah, all fair, no cheating. ALISA turned, went up the stairs and inside the canteen. Why am I doing this? Because she can set me up regardless if she wants to? She decided to anyways. Let out a heavy sigh and followed her through the door. So now I have to win against her in this tournament, and I don't remember how to play the game, so I guess we're about to find out. I can't just choose to lose against one of them. I actually have to win. Crap, how did I win this? How did I play this again? I can choose to do nothing? What? Just take my thing back. Okay, I won that. I don't really know how, but okay. That happened. I won, and now I should save just in case. Holy shit, I lost so badly. I lost so badly. Oh, no. Stop jumping forward. No. I need to freaking load. Okay, this is like the opposite method. So I'm not giving her any fours. I'm keeping these fours. Keeping these fours. You can have the fucking two. Okay, I have 2 tens now. And 2 fours. That's good. Good for me. I don't need that. Oh, yay, I still win. Woo, 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 woo. Fuck you, Oyana. Dun, 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 dun. Hey, this isn't fair. No, it's perfectly fair. You should have held back and lost. Fuck you, I don't care. She angrily puffed her cheeks, making her resemble Humpty Dumpty. Let's have a rematch, but this time you have to hold back, got it? That wasn't me who heard her, but the entire room. Even Electronic. No rematches allowed. Oyana completely ignored him. Oh, crap. I'm just gonna save just in case she makes me do it again. You have to lose. I don't have the slightest intention of playing with you a second time. I said calmly. Fine, you want it that way? Yes, that way. Then I'll put word out that you sexually harassed ALISA. Oh, fuck off. Fuck off. Oh my goodness, I came to respect you a little bit in your ending, and you just want to throw that all out the window. She whispered. What? I leaned over the table and gave her a menacing glare. So, you've been eavesdropping. I just heard it while passing by. Anyway, it's much better to play an extra round then. She can certainly do that. I sighed in appeal to Electronic. Not a problem, we'll have a quick rematch. Whatever. He shrugged. So the rematch has started. Ah, yeah, fucker. This is gonna be the norm. Yeah. Oh my goodness, I have to beat her twice. Of course I do, because it's fucking Ileana. Ooh, yes. Ah, you so stupid. Easy peasy. I sat and reclined on my seat. That's not fair. I hope she won't demand another rematch. How come? I chuckled. Okay. Said Ileana aggrievedly and got up from the table. Yeah, you're just a sore loser. I studied the tournament scheme closely, trying to understand who's going to be my final rival. Probably ALISA, because that's probably how this is going to be. And I should probably save, because I'm definitely going to have to play another match. I studied the tournament, yep, my final rival. At the same moment, ALISA took place at my table. I pulled a dumb, feigned smile. Like I'm afraid of her. Congratulations. Expecting to win? I'm expecting that you'll keep your promise. Okay, let's roll. Wait. Are we doing this the normal way, or are we doing this Ileana's? I don't remember. Ooh, I have 3 8s and 2 4s. I am in a good situation, but she just took it from me again. And I'm gonna grab it back, cause that'll really help me. Yeah. Results? Results? Oh my goodness. I absolutely destroyed her. I could have gotten another 8. I could have gotten another 4. What else did I had a jack, and there's another jack in there, I think. No, there's not another jack in there. But man, 3 8s, 2 4s, you were so annihilated, ALISA. Hooray, I won! Ah, ALISA, who knows, who rules the roost out here. That means that betting with her wasn't a waste. Yeah, I guess we'll see what happens with that. Who the hell is... Oh, that's Xenia. Xenia, okay. Now, the only thing left is to hope that she will not spread that false gossip because of her loss. Suddenly, I got the desire to celebrate victory and have a dip at the beach. What the fuck? Why would I just run out to the beach? Oh my goodness, okay, let's do that. To tell the truth, I do not really know how to swim, but the possibility of diving into cool water in the moonlight seemed really attractive at the moment. After all, I spent the whole of yesterday in my winter clothing, and surely you could nicely wring the sweat out of me. In the evening, no one should be here, so I took off all of my clothes except my underpants and entered the water. If I only knew, I would have taken my swimming trunks along. Usually, it was enough for me to swim for 15 to 20 meters, but this time, my euphoria of my victory spurred me on to break this record. I swam slowly and tactfully, watching every movement of my arms and legs and keeping my breath steady. All of a sudden, wham! Strike on my back sent me underwater. I wonder if I just as soon as the match was over, I just jumped up and was like, woo! I won! And then I just ran out to the beach just screaming, yeah! Victory! Victory! And all that beautiful, beautiful stuff. I started to drown, but managed to force myself to jump out and grab a nearby buoy. Am I naked? Am I motherfucking naked? Oh my fucking goodness. I turned and saw ALISA swimming after me. And she was already in her swimsuit for some reason. What the hell are you doing? What the hell am I doing, honestly? What am I doing? Healing the winner. What if I started drowning? Well, I save you. let's just say I'm not very inclined to believe you at the moment. Of course. It's just too dangerous to stay here. She could easily sink me again. I gathered all my strength and swam to shore. I slowly started to catch my breath. Beach sand stuck to my body from head to toe. After some time, ALISA came out of the water. You know, you swim well. I wouldn't say so. Yeah, you do? Well, wasn't that obvious? I said nothing. You won twice against me today. This means I will forget 2 of your debts. Oh, is that how you work? Oh, that seems like bullshit. What kind of debts is she talking about? It looks like ALISA has a problem with evaluating reality. Ah, that's a good way of phrasing it. Thanks a lot, I said sarcastically. You know, you're not as much of a loser as I thought. Alisa was wearing some of that perfectly emphasized the beauty of her figure, and this is clearly a fan service little scene here. While taking into account the flaws in her personality, at least this advantage of hers couldn't be taken away. So she smiled cunningly. What's wrong? Aren't you one? Of course not. Then how will you prove it? I don't have to prove anything. Oh, so is that it? She said without any anger. Yeah, that's it. The silence was expected. A light wind gently played with the wave, sending them to the shore and taking them back after. Alisa was still looking at me through, it seemed, as if it seemed she completely forgot about my presence. Hey, Earth to Alisa. Her lost look immediately switched back to her normal one. Anyway, bye-bye. Okay, bye. Goodbye. Were you just wearing your swimsuit under your clothing or something? Because that seemed a bit weird that you just ran out after me and all that stuff. Oh, she picked up her clothes lying nearby and left. Well, it was late, but I decided to spend a little bit more time lying on my back and stargazing. After all, I didn't have many opportunities for that before. Or I simply tried to avoid every opportunity. Well, if you think about it, light from faraway stars reaches us only after millions of years. Right now, I can see the star because it was shining back then, long, long in the past. But now the star's gone, already exploded. Well, not necessarily, but... Well, not necessarily, probably most of them are not exploded yet. Wait a minute. She took my clothes too. Oh, you fucker. Oh, I got up and looked around the beach. No doubt about it. At least I took my pioneer uniform. Ah, goddammit. I was just about to start thinking she's not all so spoiled. Oh, my goodness. I need to come up with an idea quickly. Certainly, I could go and complain to Olga, but not in my wet underpants. Well, why not? It would certainly make a very convincing argument that she stole your clothing. I don't know which cabin Alisa lives in either. Knocking on every door is certainly not a good idea. Maybe I should go to Slavia in my wet underpants. Yes, of course, at night wearing my underpants. The only thing missing would be a rose in my teeth. Overall, it looks like I am thoroughly screwed. In case I have to do something. I was lucky not so much time had passed since we left, but I can still catch up with Alisa. Hurry up. In the blink of an eye, I found myself at the square. To my great surprise, Alisa was sitting on a bench, apparently bored. She had already changed. Give them back. Yeah, sure, take them. She muttered with a guilty tone and handed back my uniform. Don't think I was waiting for you on purpose or anything like that. Oh, she's blushing. Aw, what a classic tsundere. Alisa turned her back and set off towards the cabin at an easy pace. I was left standing riveted and to the spot. Oh, I didn't expect such a twist. The guilt did its job, perhaps. Fat chance. Anyway, it's better to keep away from her, and recent events do not change a thing. I headed to Olga's cabin. For the first time, I felt how tired I was, etc., etc., etc. Next event time. Huh, so this is where I'm supposed to go take a look here? Coming to the stage area, I caught sight of Alisa on the stage. Oh, she's the one doing this then? Oh. You know, I'd actually be impressed by how well painted this was if there wasn't just a random panty shot in it. The girl was giving it all, her eyes closed, placed one of her legs on top of the speaker, swaying away with the body to the rhythm, and I accidentally pressed that. To the music. I couldn't recognize the melody, but I was pretty sure I'd heard it before. Probably something from Soviet rock. I could name a dozen bands from the genre right off the bat, but I was hardly an expert. The songs seemed really simple, literally just a 3-chord progression. Probably even I could have played it, given some time to practice. Wonder where Alisa got her playing skills. In the USSR, such music had never been nationally acclaimed. The future rock star wasn't taking any notice of me. Like she was trying to become one with the music, to resound every note in every bar and every triplet. Rock heroes of the 80s instantly came to my mind, many of them devoted to music in similar way. I got dressed, blah, blah, blah. The performance was coming to an end. Hang out the last couple chords, so you noticed me. Finally. God damn, that one lasted a while. But did you like it? She doesn't seem as surprised as I would have expected. Yeah, that was pretty cool. As if you could do any better, smiled Alisa slyly. I'm not saying I can do any better. I'm not a pro in music. You should go ask Miku, though. She would probably love to have you in her club. No doubt. Yep. I don't know what to tell her next. Was heading on my way. Wait a minute. What? Heard about the evening dance party? I thought it was a ball. Ball? Dance party? What's the difference? She frowned. Yes, I did, and about it. Are you going to go? After throwing out those words, she turned away. I'm not so sure. What about you? I'm like, what am I going to do there? Watch a herd of morons? There's some truth to Elisa's words, but this open disrespect surprised me. It's clear that it's not the idea of the ball she hates. But why ask me or anything? What do you mean by why? Well, why don't you want to come? Dance parties ought to be fun. You really think so? Annoyance flashed in her voice. I don't know. I thought you would. Never liked them. She interrupted me. There's absolutely nothing to do at such parties. I see. Well, I don't disagree with you, Elisa. I never really had fun when I went to those sorts of parties. It's either you hang out and talk to people, which you could just do otherwise, or you could dance, and honestly, public dancing doesn't seem all that fun to me, personally. I've never seen the appeal of it, but I know other people enjoy it, but that seems like the most appealing part of it. I see. So, what's your plan, then? I just asked to keep the conversation going. I'll just carry on practicing. So, what are you practicing? The song, dumbass. You ever even heard of it? Elisa had gone totally mad. A few more wrong questions, I'll have to run for my life. Who wrote that song? I did. So, you wrote it by yourself? By myself. Cool. I'm not really sure what's happening anymore. An awkward silence hung in the air. Okay, then. Don't you want to listen? Didn't I just hear it? That's not what I meant. She pouted. The whole song. It's just a jam for now. Oh. Come on. I guess do it then. Not right now. Oh, don't do it then. I felt uncertain about what she wanted from me. You mean you don't want me to play? No. My fucking goodness. She's such a fucking cliche tsundere. Oh my fucking goodness. It's just annoying at this point. I mean, the whole tsundere personality trope is not a horrible thing. I don't dislike it. But when their entire personality is just misunderstanding, getting mad, but they really like you, it just, I don't know. It just seems so freaking pointless. Just, it's not even comedic, honestly. You mean you don't want me to play? Seems like I frustrated her. I got ready for her to smash the guitar on my forehead or something even worse. There's only an upset expression on Elisa's face. No, I want to, I told you. Come here tonight then, I'll play for you. For me? How cute. Tonight is the dance party. You said that you wouldn't go. I said nothing of the sort. I didn't say that. Frankly speaking, I didn't want to go, but messing around with Elisa is no good either. Olga, Mitra, won't like that. Screw her. Amen to that, amen to that. Said Elisa, getting steamed up. Okay. No, I won't. Sorry, no. It says to accept her offer. Between shame at the dance party and Elisa's mad guitar skills, I'd really pick the latter. Good boy. Now I don't want to come if you're going to treat me like that. Fuck off. She smiled strangely. I was just wondering if the decision I made was the right one when I was suddenly interrupted by ringing, calling for the pioneers for lunch. I looked toward the canteen. I suppose it's time to go, hunger is a sharp thorn. I turned around with the intent to call Elisa to come along. But she just looked so cheerless and down. Every musician should know when it's time to leave. I grumbled under my breath. Alright, I was going to go see Elisa instead of going to the dance, so it's time. A few minutes later, I approached the stage. Maybe it was a bad idea accepting her offer. Just talking to her means danger. On the other hand, I wasn't eager to go to the dance either. What could I do here, even? I'd only disgrace, well, there. I'd only disgrace myself trying to dance. No, I'm better off listening to ALISA play the guitar. That actually sounds sort of kind of fun, but nope. No, it couldn't be. From closer, I saw Puss sitting on the edge of the stage with her legs dangling. So you came after all. ALISA put the guitar aside and jumped to the ground. There's even a trace of joy on her face for a moment. Playing for someone sure is more interesting than being alone. As you can see, what are we going to do? Wait, what do you mean, what? I'm asking you. Well, you wanted to... I got a sudden idea. The situation is, one of the usual pranks I should never expected any guitar songs. Going to bed. Bye. I turned around and waved a hand intentionally, slowly. Hey! ALISA grabbed my sleeve. What? Don't you want to listen? Listen to what? You yourself don't know what you're going to do. Of course I know. She took the guitar and hit the strings with a plectrum of... plectrum? A plectrum. I don't think that... There's definitely another word for those, and it's not plectrum. Sit next to me. I didn't object, and in the moment I was sitting beside her, looking incredibly bored as she serenaded me under the moonlight. It's better this way, Mr. Dance, leave now, not one word I do. Oh no, I thought she was singing for a second. Okay, my bad. Well, the stranger's most suitable for a passive observer, and not for the eager-seeker of answers, who I wanted to be so badly. So, I'll show you how to play the song now. Just like that, right away. What do you mean, right away? I haven't held a guitar for a very long time. She could probably guess how long it had been since I held one. My skills were enough to make a cat laugh. It's not difficult. I threw an intense look at ALISA. It distinctly seems to me that she just can't express her feelings very well. She could lose herself, strain self-control for a moment, and I get to see a casual and even funny and friendly girl. Then when her self-confidence and impudence turned back on, it was bitchiness as usual. And which is the real one? Let's be realistic here. She's just probably incredibly insecure. Hey! What? Stop daydreaming. No. Oh yeah, sorry. So, are you watching? I am. What song is this? The one I played this morning, of course. Okay, I'm listening. I shouldn't have expected you to have another song. My bad. Made up her mind and start to play. That's it. Did you get everything? I may have understood it, but I probably won't be able to replicate it. How should I put it? It's okay, practice makes perfect. She is undoubtedly right on this point, but I've had problems with practice all my life. Well... I took a guitar from ALISA and tried to play the first chord. It was hard, as if my fingers were tied in a knot and didn't want to be in the right place. I used to be better before, but now I wouldn't be able to play Twinkle Twinkle Little Star. Well, wait a moment. Looks like you won't be a rock hero. She laughed kindly. Might just be better this way. I hissed, vainly trying to remember the order the strings to press. Well... The car started to make a devilish sound resembling the groans of a wounded dinosaur. My left hand fingers constantly missed the right frets, and my right hand didn't strike in rhythm. Let's call that progressive rock. Progressive? Well, give it back. She took the guitar away and it sounded completely different in her hands. I felt embarrassed by my clumsiness for a moment. ALISA's skill may not be one of the top level of a professional guitarist, but nevertheless, she played simple things like this with confidence. She must have had a lot of practice on these very simple things. Did you get it this time? She finished and offered the guitar to me. Well, I don't really think the problem is whether I get it. I think I probably get it. I think I'm just not very good. Guitar pick, that was the word for it. It's a guitar pick that I'm thinking of. plectrum? Is plectrum another word for that? Yep, sorry if I cough every once in a while. I won't always be able to cut it out because of how I have to record this now. Or from any decently adequate level. I was aware of how totally worthless I was compared to her. Seems so simple, just play a song with three chords. Wait. Did she do this on purpose? Did she purposely just set me up here so she could feel so good and superior about herself after she lost at cards? Also, that guitar. I don't think guitars have that much of a... I don't think they go in that much. I could be remembering incorrectly, but I don't remember them doing that. The tune is too simple, though. I put the guitar aside. ALISA was lost in thought for a moment. Even a preschool kid could play it better. Yep, I'm sure they could. Blah, blah, thanks. Blah, blah, I tried. Blah, blah, blah. So I noticed. She might be trying to demonstrate her evident superiority at playing the guitar. It's not like everyone can be a musician. Not really. ALISA looked up at the sky. Though you can't be one, that's for sure. Why is that? You should have heard yourself. I start to regret coming here. Yep, it's just her being a bitch. Even when she's being nice, she's just trying to be a bit of a bitch. Ah, don't mind me. Why does ALISA need to do this? Isn't it obvious I'm a horrible guitarist? I mean, is she really trying to help me? Or is she... Or is she just trying to rub it in that she actually has practiced before? Obviously. But if I had some practice... So, will you practice? I don't know. Maybe I will. The guitar was the least of my problems, though. I'm stuck in a strange world I can't escape from. It's more important than a stupid argument with ALISA. I suddenly felt an annoying self-pity, apathy, and an urge to leave this place, to forget everything. Those feelings left a nasty impression and a burning desire to do or say something stupid. As if it would change anything. What? Me learning to play the guitar... You surely couldn't. You strum the guitar for a couple of days and give it up. Lisa's words pierced my heart. That actually sounded sort of motivating in, like, a mean way, but... Yeah, you might. You're probably right. Let's be realistic here. You know what? Oh, well, should she know? Is it any concern of hers? Am I reacting this way just because it's true, and it's ALISA who spoke that truth? Oh, you can't know how to do everything. Probably not. But you should be able to do at least be able to do something. So, are you saying I can't do anything? How should I know? Oh, you know, I what? Should I tell her about my computer skills? Or about the books I've read or the movies I've watched? Oh, well, this is a pointless conversation. That goes without saying. Fuck off. You're only concerned with having fun. I wouldn't even call it having fun. I'd say it's building your frickin' self-confidence. And you do nothing but whine.
Yeah, because you keep being a bitch.
Forget it. I jumped down from the stage and walked away from the concert area. Go then. I heard ALISA yelling to me. I'm already going. I hissed. Well, if the Oyana ending taught me that she's not so bad, this ending's currently teaching me she's just as bad as I thought she was. The path led me back to the square. Slavy and Senovit sweeping the area. Oh, Semyon. Hi, I thought everyone was already asleep. Nope. What are you doing? And how the hell did I spend so much time on the guitar that the dance is already over? Coming up after the ball. Why didn't you come? Just... Where have you been? I hadn't the slightest intention of telling Slavia how I embarrassed myself on stage with the guitar in front of ALISA while the whole camp was having fun at the square. I took a walk, I guess. Okay, but you should have come. It was fun. Glad you enjoyed yourself. I've been sweating like a pig today because of worries or just the hot night. Hey, do you know where I can have a bath? Certainly. Go straight, then a bit to the left by the path, then to the right, and there will be a bathhouse. Should I accompany you? No need. I'll find it myself. I totally didn't want to burden her more. Are we back to this thing? All my problems, if not went away, then at least became less important. Like the water washed away not only the dirt from my body, but also the anxiety from my mind. I suddenly started yawning, so I headed to the leader's cabin, rubbing my eyes. I didn't take even a few steps before Alisa jumped out of the bushes. You, what are you doing here? Just washing myself. Why do you have to question everything I do? My goodness. She came to a sentence and spoke again. And what? How should I know? There is no and. Oh, and goodbye? That's one. And goodbye. I'm waving my hand now. Then why do you speak if you don't know? All my peace of mind vanished in a moment. Only the irrational and the wariness remain. Okay, well, if you don't mind... Wait. Oh, what? If back there on stage you thought that, well, I didn't want to offend you or anything. Oh, I'm so sorry that you're really not that horrible of a person as you purposely act to be, but it's still annoying. It's okay, I'm not offended, I just can't play the guitar, nothing special, a lot of people can't. I thought there was an obvious sign of irritation in my voice, but I couldn't do anything about it. I wanted to say everything to her face right here, right now. Exactly, you can't. You can't see it, but I'm giving her the middle finger right now. Here's my bird. It's not even an owl. Lisa obviously restrained herself from laughing. Oh, I've already had enough of you. She totally drove me out of my wits at that moment. Another second, I would have started to yell at her. Or worse. Wait, could you just leave me alone? Lisa followed me but didn't try to stop me. I really didn't want to offend. Some invisible power made me turn around. Okay, can I go now? Yes, of course. In the moonlight, Alisa looked very beautiful with a brief, guilty expression on her face. That's such a weird observation to have when you're... Why would you be paying attention to what she looks like when you're furious with her? Why would a person do that? She could only keep her mouth shut. What are you smirking at? Although... Nothing. I just thought if only you were a bit more polite. Then what? I shouldn't say such things. People get ideas. Well, depending on their intellectual abilities. Then nothing. You should finish what you started. There's nothing to finish. I'm very tired, and I'm going to sleep. Stop right there. Don't make me run away from you. As if you could. She may be right. I'm already exhausted from this day. Naturally, I had no intention of running after a bath. So what? What? If only I would be more polite, then what? Stop getting so mad. Try it, and you'll see. Why should you do anything for a fool like you? Oh, don't worry. It's not for me. It's for everyone. Then don't try. What does it have to do with me? I sighed and dragged myself to the square. And what about you then? Oh my goodness. Drop it. For fuck's sake. What? I replied without turning to her. Well, if you would, then you... I don't know what you're talking about, but let's think that I would if it were easy for you. Moron. Alisa yelled at me and headed to the bathhouse. Oh my fucking goodness. In any other situation, I have surely said that Alisa likes me and just hides it because of her rudeness. Or behind her rudeness. You know what? I mean, it feels like the game's trying to make it seem like that. But maybe it'll be more complex than that and she won't just be a tsundere. Ugh, it's not important right now, though. I'm supposed to say that I make up another excuse. Okay, what's my excuse gonna be? I was just walking around. Alone? Oh yeah, she's asking me why I wasn't at the dance. And I really don't see why I need an excuse in the first place. I was just walking around, alone, I'm fine, whatever, who cares, just drop it. Okay, that's not important. Why didn't you come to the ball? Well, frankly speaking, I don't like dancing. So what? Is it a good Soviet child's duty to go to all the dance balls now? I don't have to go to shit if I don't fucking feel like it. Oh my goodness. I'm so fucking tired of all these people fucking nagging me for the stupidest shit. Ah, blah, 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 blah. You just sit somewhere quietly. Oh, I don't fucking care. Just shut. Did I really just apologize? I said I'm sorry. Fuck that. Ah, just gonna go to bed. Oh, this is new. Okay, so she just tried to frame me for sneaking into her cabin. She said, I wanted to take revenge. For what? Really? What did I do to this girl to want revenge? You beat me in cards. Well, fuck off. You've been such a bitch, I don't fucking care. What a fantastic reason. No doubt. I see. Maybe I should apologize to you. Yes, okay. Goodbye. Okay. Never mind. Okay, I have to go with her. I have to go with ALISA on this one. Okay. To go find Shirk. Yeah, she should have read my mind. Wait, why? Read my mind? What did I think? That I wanted to go with her? No, I never would thought that. Why's that? Well, who tried to blow up the monument? If that wasn't enough, who also tried to slander Semyon? She said in such a voice that ALISA did not dare to argue. Happy now? She blurted out once we were left alone. What do I have to do with this? Was it me who tried to blow up the monument? ALISA grunted and turned away. I'm not going anywhere with you. So be it, I know I can get through it by myself. Oh, please don't. Great then. Excellent. We stood silently for a while, not looking at each other. I dare break the silence first. Is that really all? All what? All you wanted to tell me? Yeah, that's all. Do you mind then if I inquired why you tried to blow up the monument? I was bored. Oh, that's such a fucking bad reason. Ugh. Right. Blowing it up would have definitely cheered you up, I'm sure. Oh, might have cheered me up a little bit. Just a little bit. ALISA seemed really reluctant to go with me. As for me, however, I've decided to find Shirk after all. It wasn't him who interested me the most, but the abandoned camp. For some reason, I had the feeling that I might find something out there. I did not really like the idea of going alone at night. So, you scared then? Are you daring me? She gave me a sarcastic smile. Oh no, I never. Good luck if you're staying then. I turned around and started walking the direction the old camp should have been. ALISA caught up with me at the forest edge. Wait up. I'm going with you. Ah, did you decide to change your mind after all? I asked ironically. Oh, you don't need to know. She snarled and handed me a flashlight. I was quite wise. I don't know what I've done there, alone in the dark, if it wasn't for ALISA. Electronic had told us to use the old building. It told us the old building was built right after the war. It looked like a kindergarten, or like barracks, I expected, and definitely could hold fewer pioneers than today's camp. It had been abandoned for about 20 years. ALISA suddenly stopped, so suddenly that I nearly bumped into her. Now where? Well, wait, straight ahead, I guess? Are you sure? I tried to figure out the directions. So we're going the right way. Or at least the way suggested by electronic. However, without a map, or without a GPS, or GLONASS navigation, whatever. I wasn't even sure that we were still on the same planet. Well, wherever it was. We haven't taken any turns. We've been walking straight forward all the time, just as electronic said. Why haven't we made it to the old camp yet? How the fuck should I know? ALISA's rude way of talking was already getting my nerves. Are we already lost? Why would you say that? We are barely a kilometer away from the camp. So what? She looked visibly sadder. So nothing. If you don't like it, you can go back. ALISA eyed me disappointingly for a while, and then her face changed sharply. Well, I will then. She suddenly turned around and started marching briskly back towards the camp. Good luck. I shouted as she was going. Oh, good for me. I got a flashlight out of the deal. And now she's not here. She may be right, and we are in fact lost, in which case not a good idea to stay here alone. The cold night breeze blew stronger, and I shivered. But going after her would mean losing face, and even worse, admitting she's right. No, I'm not ready to accept that. I could have probably spent until morning arguing myself about this, but if it weren't for Elisa's scream, Ah, great. She carried me on their own towards where she went. About 20 meters, I fell into a hole. I nearly fell into a hole, just managed to jump over at the last moment. As for ALISA, it looked like she had not managed to. I was about to point the flashlight into the darkness when I realized she'd taken it with her. Well, that had to be expected. Are you alive? Yeah. Her muffled voice sounded up from below. Did you break anything? Hell if I know, idiot. Baka. A light flickered in the hole. I stepped closer and bent it to examine how deep it was. The crumbling hole went about 3 meters into the depths, but it was pitch black below. Help me get out, ALISA yelled angrily. How do you imagine I should do that then? I don't know, think of something. Well, what do you see now? Describe it. A sort of a tunnel, not just a tunnel. Tunnel? That's weird. Come on, get down here. It's the best idea I have. I'd rather run for camp on a rope. Run to camp for a rope. You're gonna leave me here alone? Lisa's voice lost much of its impotence. But you're not alone down there anyways. Hey! She cried out loud and directed the flashlight right into my eyes. Well, don't panic. Trolls aren't gonna eat you. I'll be back in a flash. ALISA was screaming herself into a fit down below, but I couldn't make out the words. Probably something involving swell. I only managed a few steps before the ground yielded under my feet, and before I knew it, I was tumbling down. I grabbed a thin rope and somehow slowed my fall. But it snapped under my weight, and I went flying down with me. Ah, great. I'm guessing this is how we get into the tunnel. You're alive?
Nope. I'm just dead here, taking a short nap.
I barely opened one eye as I felt a searing spotlight upon me. Ah, put it away. ALISA was squatting next to me and looking at me in a nervous manner. Any limbs broken?
I don't know.
I moved my hands and feet. Everything seemed to be fine. Given the height, I was pretty lucky to make it down alive. I barely managed to stand up and examine the crash site. Indeed, we were in some kind of long corridor. It was some kind of heavy wiring along with the wiring and whatnot. And this looks like the same place we've been in. We are down here, so let's probably...
I don't know how we managed to...
It's sort of weird that we have this whole situation of falling down here instead. I guess it's time to go look if there's any differences in how this plays out. So she's grabbing my hand, apparently. Even though you can clearly see that's not actually happening in the actual picture. But in other circumstances, I might have been surprised, embarrassed, or even rejoiced. How should I know? But right now, I was just eager to get out of here as soon as possible.
Oh, Semyon, you're just a little too honest sometimes.
She said she's scared. What are you scared of? Indeed, what of? ALISA, you wouldn't happen to know something? We tumbled down to an abandoned bomb shelter, and yeah, I mean, there's plenty to be afraid of. Sort of wondering if you know more than you're letting on.
Well, it is what it is. I don't think I'll get any answers of those, of that nature for quite some time.
So, I showed her my wound and she said we had to sanitize it, and she insisted, even though I said we didn't really need to. She found a first aid kit pretty easily.
Okay, treating the wound with such and such.
Oh, do you have some sort of experience, ALISA, with...
She said her granddad died in the war.
Don't you think that was anything special? We just had to treat your injuries.
Ah, yep, she's back.
She seemed really useful there for a second, and really, I was actually quite appreciative. And then she ruined the moment.
God damn it, ALISA.
Are you alright? No, she said quietly. I understand that it can't be okay, but how are you holding up?
Fine.
She replied with an indifferent voice. That's good because, I really wanted to say, because if you go nuts too, it's gonna be a massacre.
We will find an exit. She's been very scared and not very much herself down here. She's had flashes of it, yes, but I feel as though the whole point of this is to show her softer side where she's not being a bitch just because she feels like being a bitch because she doesn't have the time to be concerned over all of that.
Did she really just do that?
No. No, ALISA really just went up to him and slapped him. Did that bring him to his senses? You, we nearly died while searching for you. Those damn woods at nights, that bomb shelter, those freaking mines. Some massive bruises thanks to you. And you what? You're just hanging out drinking booze and seeing pink spiders, you bastard? Pink spiders? There are pink spiders here? What the fuck? Shark stared at her with a bemused look. Now then, get your ass up and move. No. He began to whisper quietly. No. Somewhere deep inside me, the very edge of my awareness, I got a feeling something really bad was about to happen. Okay, this is gonna happen again. So, we got back to the hole. Huh. And because we fell in, that actually makes a bit of sense. And because we fell in instead of coming through the school, we didn't know what direction to go. So we sat down, and she asked, "Are we going to die here?" And she rested her head upon my shoulders. Her voice sounded flat, one might even say calm, but I could feel her body was trembling, either with cold or fear or both combined. Oh, don't be silly. Things are getting worse, but there's still plenty far from we're gonna die. They'll come and rescue us in the morning. I'll go call the police, so... I'd love to believe that myself. I see. Yeah. I lost track of time sitting there. I was afraid to go forward or backwards. I was afraid to make a choice. So our torch definitely wouldn't last both ways. Wandering into darkness without any source of light was definitely worse than waiting for the rescue. For the rescue here. This way, at least we would have some light left for an emergency. Suddenly a rumbling started to echo in the distance. Well, here is that emergency. It's definitely the clink of a door, bolts mixed in that rumbling. Get up. I harshly pulled ALISA to her feet and lifted the torch with shaking hands. She's been very scared and clingy this entire time, especially when she got attacked by Shirk. I harshly pulled ALISA to her feet and lit the torch with shaking hands. What is it? She asked in dismay. I don't know, but it seems like there's someone here. We have to run. To be honest, I wasn't sure that it was such a good idea. What if Mad Shirk is there? In fact, that's the least of all the evils I can imagine. We had no choice left. The stone scattered beneath our feet desperately tried to not fall down, holding my hand at the torch out in front and dragging ALISA with the other. She ran along in silence, breathing heavily. I really wanted to look back to her, but we didn't have the strength or time. Finally, the outline of the open door appeared before us, and I leaped into the bomb shelter, readying myself to fight any foe that was there. But the room was empty. I swept my eyes across the room, trying hard to spot hidden monsters, Shirk, or any evil entity. But it was exactly the same as it was the first time we'd been here, except for the door, the second door. It was open! Somebody's already passed through here. I spoke triumphantly. Who? I don't know, maybe it was Shirk. But how did he manage to open it? Who the hell cares? Come on. And then we went through that, and then we went to find... Yep, that's fine. Yep, we found the whole place. Yep, we're here. We're good. ALISA sat on one of the swings and wiped the sweat from her forehead with the back of her hands. I see, so we found it after all. I smiled involuntarily. What are you laughing at? She frowned and pouted with displeasure. Not at you. I'm laughing at the irony. I don't even know if it counts as irony. The coincidence of the situation. She frowned and pouted with displeasure. But shortly, she returned to her usual self. Goody. So it's not so scary here anymore. I wasn't scared there either. Oh, come on. That's right, it wasn't. Oh, whatever. I was angry. I really felt hurt because of ALISA. If not for me, she would still have been down there in that damn mine. Where are you going? She asked in a less self-assured voice as I turned around and walked slowly towards the camp. Back to camp. Hey! ALISA jumped right away and started to walk next to me. For a moment, I wanted to say something nasty, but I wasn't ready to start the next argument. I found the path that we had taken before surprisingly fast, even the two holes we'd fallen into. It was only about 200 meters from the old camp. So were we actually going to make it there if we just kept heading forward? Was it all ALISA's fault? I stopped at the square and turned to ALISA. Well? Well, she looked uncertain, even confused.
Then...
Sure. Deep inside, I want to yell at her, to scold her, or even to insult her. Oh, man, I want to insult her. I want to actually insult her in-game, not just me yelling at the screen. I know some people like the character. I know some people like the trope. Actually, I don't mind the trope. I just really dislike how it's being implemented here. So I'm sorry if you like the character and I'm ragging on her. I'm sure she has her redeemable qualities, but I don't know what they are. That's about the only way I can phrase it. On the other hand, I wanted to have a meaningful conversation as well. On the end, I just kept silent, turned around, and headed towards the cabin. But something persistently disturbed the quiet of the night. I keenly listened to it and realized that it was snoring. Of Shirk, who was on the bench. Yep, we're gonna do this again. For the third time. He said that he doesn't remember anything, and that is unscientific and nonsense like that. I think he really just doesn't remember because of the shock and stress. Who am I to say? I was in the same boat not too long ago. I am still in it, though. Do I have amnesia? Well, why did he come here? Then again, I knew the answer. That's exactly why I hadn't gone to sleep, but waited for her here. Well, Lisa sat down next to me. Kind of wanted to thank you after all down there, you know, no problem. I said gently and leaned back. Well, all right then. She got up and was going to go. If you think that I'm angry with you, I'm not. Everything is okay. Okay. I'll give you one more chance. Just reset it. I don't care about the stuff you've done so far. Just be a nice be a good person, please. I don't actually think that. At least I got worked up. Fine then. Whatever. Okay. Yep. Then, just go already. I said kindly and waved my hand. I'll go when I want to. So now you don't want to. I want to. Well, is something preventing you from going? Moron. Baka. Alisa stamped her foot quickly and walked away from the leader's cabin. I took a deep breath and stood up. My head was terribly dizzy from fatigue. Well, at least Olga is sleeping already, and I wouldn't have much to explain. However, it wasn't that easy. The camp leader was standing in the middle of the room and obviously preparing for a lengthy conversation. Rather for a debriefing. Would you care to explain? What's the matter? In fact, you didn't mind when we were going to search for Shirk? And what? Have you found him? Looks like she is more concerned about me coming back late than the fate of the lost pioneer. Shocking. Yes, we have. By the way, why are you standing here in the darkness? What? What? I said, why in the darkness? Because it's time to sleep. You don't look ready to sleep. You're in your pioneer uniform still. I couldn't agree with her more, although slightly surprised that about the abrupt mood swing. I just barely stumbled into my bed and collapsed onto it without undressing. But still, Alisa, I just didn't know what I should think of her. Honestly, personally, I'm pretty confident what I think of her. It's because she's been acting strange recently. No, on the contrary, all of her behavior was quite consistent and understandable. Yeah, albeit annoying from both perspectives. Even her returning to thank me. I thought of Alisa much more than anything else that had happened tonight. Although if you get down to it, there's nothing supernatural about it. Uncomfortable, sure, frightening, yeah, even spine-chilling, sure. Something related to my arrival here, hardly. But these thoughts put me to sleep. Curiosity killed the cat. Anyway, it's Alisa, and that means I could quickly turn into a mess, plus I still have the ingredients to collect. Well, I'll come later. Okay, Alisa left the library without looking at me. That's anticlimactic. Well, there's not much else I have to do to actually, quote-unquote, get her ending. This is one of the last things, and... I actually had to come back to this. I wasn't able to finish this up last time I was recording this like I was hoping to. Turns out I had several less hours than I expected. So, kind of thinking what could this book be about if she's so ashamed of it? Wasn't it like some random Soviet thing? It was like incredibly random and completely pointless. Ah, whatever. Ah, the thing I've never had to press before. Try to find out what ALISA and Lena are arguing about. Only Lena and ALISA stood out among all the splendor. Well, of course, it was quite natural for ALISA to be arguing with someone like that, but hearing Lena talk in a raised voice, I came closer silently, trying to understand what was going on. Now, you listen to me. Whoa, she really looks mad. She looks like she normally does. I'll think whatever you want. I've said everything. It looks quite serious. I tried as hard as I can not to attract any attention, and it looks like I'm just going to be standing there with no intention of listening on them. Well, hopefully it'll look like that. There's nothing to think about. Everything is clear as day. Don't try to wind me around your little finger like that. I know you too well. Why, of course you know everything. Then why won't you tell him yourself? I was getting angry. That alone was really weird, even considering that I didn't know what they were arguing about. That's none of your business. ALISA snorted, turned around, and her eyes met mine. Seconds later, Lena gave me a look as well. The girls stood there in confusion for some time. Both of them seemed to be much more wary of their weird expressions. The girls stood there in confusion for some time. You're eavesdropping? No. No, that is not what you take from it. That is not what you take from it. Me? No. I was just, like, passing. But no. I overheard you arguing, so I just came over here. I didn't have a chance to actually speak. Come on. I heard nothing. I put on the best smile I had, but it didn't seem to help much. By the way, today he was peeping on me. ALISA gave a malicious smile. Lana looked at me questioningly. Sometimes words. First of all, why would she believe this devious fox's stories? I didn't peep. I didn't do... I might have, but it was censored. Come on! I know quite well that it... you know quite well it was an accident. Oyana should be the one to blame. Sure it was. Tell that to the cops. Seems like my excuse was not working. Did he like my boobs? Shiver ran up my spine. Is that true? Lena looked at me imploringly. Wait, oh, it was an accident. I didn't see anything there. You didn't? Well, I can show you again. ALISA cried in anger. I didn't know what to say. You see, I told you. No. Lena started to mumble and rushed away a moment later. Oh. What the fuck were you two even arguing about to begin with? What, I mean, when you... One of them said tell him. I assume tell me. I mean, unless the only other reason I could imagine them possibly needing to tell anyone anything is electronic about Xenia, maybe? But I don't know. Wait, what happened? I shouted after her. You see what you did there? That girl is upset now. My fucking goodness. You know, after all this, the game still makes no attempt to make you seem remotely likable in any way or form. Oyana may have been annoying and may have been over the top, like, trying to have fun. But at least she was, like, semi-relatable. She was childish, but that was about it. You're just being a bitch. 100% a bitch. And I have no better way to put it. She gave a spiteful smile. First of all, it wasn't me who upset her. Second, I don't have any idea what you two were arguing about. I was running out of patience. Why should I tell you? It seems like she thought that our talk was over and was about to leave. I grabbed her hand abruptly. ALISA glanced at me in fear, but I didn't say anything. I was angry at the moment, really angry. First, I was wildly enraged that Lena was upset because of me, even though I was actually kind of guilty, but still. Second, I was enraged by ALISA's insolence. Third, whoops. Fucking notification. Sorry. One sec. Third, I was so tired that I was about to lose my temper at the smallest thing. Happy now? I hissed, pointing into the darkness where Lena had run off. You only seem to have the guts to bomb memorials and hurt innocent girls. She looked frightened, saddened, and confused at the same time. She herself could hurt anyone. Just don't know her. Anyone could hurt anyone. That's such a fucking shit excuse. The only truth here is
is that I don't know her too well, but I'm absolutely positive that she wouldn't hurt anyone. That's your job. We stood in silence for some time. Held Elisa's hand and didn't know what to do next. Solution dawned upon me all by myself. All by itself, yeah. You have to go and apologize. Why the hell should I? Elisa tried to act as arrogant as always, but it wasn't going to work this time. Cause I said so. I refused to hear any objections dragged through the side of the bonfire. Oga, I'm sorry, but we have some urgent business to deal with, so we have to leave early. The guidance officer tried to object, but I didn't listen and headed after Lena, pulling Elisa along with me. After some time, I released her hand. Any objections? All the pride and arrogance had left Elisa's face long ago. If you want me to come with you, I will, but I've nothing to apologize for. I told her the truth. We'll see about that then. I cut her short. Night came down on the camp while we searched for paddles and potted around with the ropes. One boat was actually missing. Okay, today is your lucky day. You get to do the several killer exercises that will build up your biceps, triceps, and other arm muscles, I said sarcastically. Are you serious? Elisa cast a fearful glance at me. Well, perhaps that was a little too rough, even for her. Alright, I won't make you row, of course. That hardly sounded confident. You know, maybe we should make her row, but we should help row too. You know, multiple people can... Oh, no, wait, no. If I try to row with Elisa, she's just going to sabotage it. You actually have to row in unison as a team, don't you? Swing the paddles appears to be much harder this time. Well, that's not surprising, considering that today I must have filled my annual rowing quota. Stopped in the middle of the river to catch my breath. The camp was covered by night. Trivial and ordinary night. One of those nights in the dark sky, crescent moon, don't feel anything special, crippling chirkets, quittering birds, etc., etc., etc. I was staring into the darkness, trying to make out the shadowy island. How did you get to know her? Elisa shivered a little. We grew up together. Really? There aren't a whole lot of situations where people seem to know each other in this mysterious, mysterious camp. She answered slowly after some hesitation. Semyon and ended up the same pioneer camp. What a fabulous coincidence. All these questions, mysteries, and fears have been so well hidden so far suddenly spawned in my head. Damn, I could just throw her out of the boat and drown her right now. Whoa. That's a bit too dark, Semyon. She's a bitch, but you don't want to fucking kill people over that. I can demand answers. Although, it could be dangerous unless I'm sure I know what I'm doing. I still thought that this time I was playing with the white piece so I can make the first move. Not just parry the blows of the opponent. So, what kind of camp is this? Elisa stared at me blankly. Where are we? Why am I here? She kept silent. Answer me! I shouted. Hey, what's wrong with you? If you want me to apologize to Lena, I will. That's when I realized how stupid I was acting, to say the least. She could simply be uninvolved in all that stuff. And what's more, one can't lie that convincingly. Elisa's fearful expression was yet another reason to believe her. Oh, sorry. That was all I was able to say at the moment. Yet I wanted to keep my advantage. The last few meters were really rough. Exhausted, I got out of the boat and lay on the cold ground. Elisa stood nearby, staring at me. I thought she was about to goad me or utter some barbed witticism. But since she remained silent, I assumed she was still shocked or something. Even though it was rather dark here, it would be easier to hide my old flat than on this tiny island. Furthermore, Lena must have already heard us when we were crossing the river, so by now it's already too late to ask Elisa any more questions, even though I still had some. Listen, I looked at her, saw nothing, it was dark, and I didn't have cat's eyes. When we find Lena, you're going to tell her you never wanted to hurt her feelings. Everything happened this morning was nothing but a misunderstanding, okay? My voice didn't sound as confident as it did a couple of minutes ago, but confident enough. Although Elisa said nothing, it was clear by the look on her face that she agreed. I stood up and we went off to find Lena. Ah, this is going to go well. I didn't expect this outcome. My cheeks turned red and hot, and my breath was taken away. I could barely say anything. The situation didn't favor conversation, so we headed into the grove. A couple of minutes, I regained some control of myself. Come on, there's really nothing to be afraid of. We can game here during the day, gathering some strawberries, no big deal. Just normal birch grove. It's really nice in here during the day. I added it after a short pause. She didn't look at me, staring somewhere in the distance. That's up to you, after all. A few moments later, she pointed somewhere in front of us. There she is. I peered into the darkness but could barely see anything. When we came closer, we saw Lena sitting beside a tree. She was crying. "Why have you come here?" she asked tearfully. "And you?" She looked at ALISA but didn't finish the sentence. That moment, ALISA released my hands. "Well, you see, I just wanted to apologize for being somewhat harsh and rude." ALISA interrupted me. Her voice had regained that usual arrogance of hers. Maybe it's because she didn't want to look weak in front of Lena. "What a perfect apology. Not walking the walk, are you? How clever of you to insist that I'm doing a bad thing and then do that same thing yourself." Lena switched to shouting uncontrollably. "You got it all wrong. I get what I've seen. Wait, you see, girl, what? Okay, not sure what's happening anymore. I'm just gonna sit back and let this play out. You're arguing again, and I seem to be involved in all that, but I don't understand a thing. Explain it to him." Lena said to ALISA with a grin. "There's nothing to explain. Maybe you'll let me have a try then?" "Whatever." She crossed her arms over her chest and turned away. "Well then, Semyon, she blamed me for pursuing you." For a minute, there was a complete silence. "Wait, what? I totally get the idea that Lena, likes Semyon. I mean, that's not quite unobvious in some ways, but I wouldn't say anywhere in this route that it seemed like Lena specifically was pursuing Semyon." For a minute, there was a complete silence. Lena didn't look like explaining any further, and as for me, I stood trying to assemble the scattered pieces of the puzzle into a whole. "What do you mean?" "Exactly what I said. It's not like that, and it's not what I meant," interrupted ALISA. "Of course. You've always been like this." Lena burst into tears again. Wait, how come... So wait, Lena likes me? "And you, what about you? You're trying to convince me that it's all wrong while you're holding his hands." "What, so ALISA likes me too?" "Oh, come on, ALISA actually liking someone? That can't be happening. It was just like it was dark in here, and that's so much like you. Why so arrogant, always trying to control others, but when it comes to yourself..." ALISA didn't answer. I really felt like I had to say something to defuse the situation. "Hey, wait. Perhaps we just got it all wrong. There's nothing to do with you." Elisa's voice was oddly distant. "Oh no, I think it has plenty to do with me. Judging by the conversation, this has everything to do with me." "Yes, it does. Ask her what she thinks of you and why she told me not to go after you." "I don't think Lena was actually going after me." "Okay." She never gave that impression during this specific storyline, so that would be a bit weird if this was like the first thing you played. "I don't think Lena was actually going after me. I'm telling you once again, we heard enough of your story already." Lena shot up and ran away into the darkness. I stood nailed to the spot, not sure what to do next. If I found Lena now, what would I say when I found her? After all, I don't even understand what this is all about. My cluelessness and silly attempts to console her would only upset her more. I guess we better leave her alone for some time. I didn't sound very confident. Whatever. Without another word, ALISA headed back to the boat. Hey, I'm sorry I went that way. Only haven't overheard your conversation. Seems like I was feeling pathological. I need to excuse myself. It's not your fault at all. She said absentmindedly. Just that you appeared in the right place at the right time and restarted a mechanism that stood still for a long time. I don't quite get it. Of course you don't. Actually, you shouldn't right now. You'll get it later. She cast an intense glance at me. Well, that was pretty suspicious. Why the fuck? Okay. Damn it. Why does this always happen to me? Well, that school and college trouble seemed to have chosen me as its primary target. Someone blocked the classroom's door with a mop? Well, I got a written reprimand in the mark book. There was a fight. All things misconstrued, I must have started it. Failed an exam? Well, of course, that's my fault, and the teacher who hates me has nothing to do with it. Even my parents always seem to prefer blaming me rather than unfavorable circumstances, a third party's involvement, or decrees of providence. At some point, I even started to believe that I somehow do attract trouble. Remember Murphy's Law? In my case, it was like, if something nasty is gonna happen, it's gotta be me. So basically, Semyon is the equivalent of Larry Butts. Yeah, that sounds about right. For that reason, I always tried to stay out of any trouble where I could be the whipping boy. Well, judging by today, I'm not really all that good at it. Seems like you've got an aura of some sort of... Well, you do attract attention. Surprised, I looked at ALISA. She's smiling. Well, looks like she can read my mind. Trouble, mostly. Who knows? She said dreamily and stared at the river. It's a wonderful night, isn't it? Her disposition has changed considerably, it seems. Just like any other, if you ask me. I felt used up. That's exactly what I'm talking about. Just an ordinary night, nothing special. The best moment to make our most admirable camp leader really happy. She has to know that her favorite pioneer is a nasty pervert who enjoys peeking at naked girls. Something snapped inside of me again. Oh my goodness, she seemed like she was being okay for a second, and now she's just being a bitch again. You aren't serious, are you? Why, of course I'm serious. She didn't look at me like she was joking at all. Oh, fucking suit yourself. But do you really think this is the best time to do that? Aren't you supposed to row? I realized that our boat was still drifting in the river. Wait. Don't dodge my question. Let's get back to the camp. I'll have a moment to think it over. Getting to spend an entire night in a boat wasn't something I would aspire to, so I had to apply myself to the paddles. Well, eventually. We barely made it to the pier. I was exhausted, but because of the rowing and because of Elisa's intent to tell Olga about this morning incident, if I know our camp leader, her reaction will be quite predictable. So are you actually going to visit Olga now, are you? Why not? She gave her most roguish smile. It is night, after all. She must be sleeping already. Who knows, she might be awake. Come on, you know full well it was a coincidence. Some misunderstanding triggered by Oyana. No, I don't. She flung her arms up and headed to the camp. Because all my returning strength jumped up and followed her. Of course, I ended up grabbing her, but then she might have a good idea after what happened today. Oh, hold on. I trudge energetically along next to her. Let's talk this over. Is there anything to discuss? She silently walked alongside each other for some time. At least she walks slowly enough that I had no trouble keeping pace with her, and I'm thankful for it. Hey, is there anything I do convince you not to tell Olga? Not sure, but, well, there is one thing. We came to the square. So what is it? Well, stop chasing Elena, for instance. I haven't been trying to do that in the slightest in this route. I haven't tried to do that in any route. Well, I think the extent of that is I told her that she looked good in that one dress I was imagining in this. I think that's one of the only things I actually was even close to going for her route in this one. And that's just because it made it quicker to jump through it because I hadn't selected the other one before. Oh, for God's sake, what makes her think I'm chasing Elena? Sorry to lose my temper. What are you? Why are you even making up such nonsense? You started that quarrel in the forest. Because of you, we had to go to that island, and here we go again. Enough is enough. I am not chasing her. Elisa stood still, bright moonlight lighting up her face, even though it sort of looks more like dawn at the moment. Which showed evident signs of resentment and displeasure. I don't see how you look at her. How do I look at her? Like that. Like what? You know. She shifted her gaze, but remained standing still. Hey, stop seeing everyone through your twisted imagination. If you can't stop making up nonsense stories, then at least keep them to yourself. Don't make others suffer because of you and your stories. I don't care if you pick on me, but now you got Lena involved. I really lost my temper for good, but ALISA didn't answer. We sank into an unexpected silence that was only broken by ALISA's spare sobs. From bad to worse, now you are crying? Have you gone mad here? I clasped my hands in despair. I can understand why Lena was crying, but seeing ALISA crying is unthinkable to say the least. I can't even see her reasoning.
I guess she's assumed their age. She really likes Semyon and she just doesn't know how to express it and blah 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 blah.
Bad excuse after bad excuse. At any time, I would definitely be shocked, but at this moment, I'm just tired, too tired for that. Mine was absolutely blank. To be precise, it was so heavy and full that not even a single idea would have stood a chance to dwell there. I would even compare my brain at its prime to a broad highway full of speeding thoughts overtaking each other and causing gigantic chaotic crashes, then now it's nothing but a forgotten tiny path in a distant, desolate forest which is only used in times of absolute necessity. Elisa kept silent, and at least she stopped crying. If you really think it's so serious, go ahead and tell everything to Olga. Hope it makes you feel better.
Okay, I won't do it,
she said quietly and turned to me. The tears were gone, but her face seemed to express absolute sorrow at the world. I'm just feeling hurt. What hurt you? I asked her tiredly. It's always like that. She gets all the attention and always pushes me aside.
Okay, great. That's not really a good excuse.
I had difficulty understanding what she was talking about and decided to play along. Hopefully she finally leave me alone. Oh, that's not true. You do draw attention. People don't overlook you. I don't. I raised my eyes and looked at her. Her facial expression was a mixture of amazement and expectation. See?
So you... could you...
wait, what? Semyon, you did not think this through. All of a sudden, her voice became so tender that I flinched in astonishment. Elisa's face turned red, and she hid her eyes.
So, you really think that I'm as good as her?
In what fucking way? You're certainly more bitchy than her. You're so much better at that than her. Oh my goodness. I want to say something like, even better, but then I stopped myself. Yeah, I do. She seemed like she didn't understand that I said it as an absolute insincerity. Alright, time to sleep. Elisa suddenly yelled cheerfully. Now she was acting more like herself again. See you tomorrow. She waved her hand and ran away, sighed in relief. Well, if that's it for the day. Ah, okay. Apparently I woke up pretty early, landed here for some reason, and came across... Who else but Elisa? It is her ending, after all, and it should be the good one, too, so... I don't know, hopefully it'll make me not hate her. As much as the route has made me hate her even more. Elisa... came closer and stopped, not sure what to say. Suddenly she turned around and stared at me. Been standing here long?
Nope.
Why aren't you asleep? Why aren't you? She turned back and stared at the river again. It's like I'm not the only one in a good mood today. At least she wasn't being sassy again.
Can't sleep.
I see. About yesterday. You get everything, right? What exactly? Oh, for God's sake! My answer didn't seem to go down too well. Right, I did? I'm sure that'll please her. I lied. Alright, good. She suddenly looked me straight in the eye and smiled. In that case, I have plans for you tonight. May I ask what they are? You don't need to know. I mean, my impression is that she likes Semyon. She's a tsundere, so that makes her be a very... unlikable person in general. And I'm guessing she's planning something good, but maybe I should fear it. I'm probably going to fear it. Well, since I'm a part of them, you'll know when it's time. Can you give me a hint at least?
Nope.
She got up and walked towards me. A bit scared, I cleared the way. Don't do anything stupid. Well, you say that, but no promises. Elisa said, moving away from the boat shed. I wonder what she meant. What are those plans? I had no wish to become part of some terrorist act against the monument or anything. Besides, I was still haunted by yesterday's talk with Lena on the island. She's probably still angry. Good morning, you're early today. Yep, I looked up and saw Lena standing in front of me. She was smiling. You too. All of last night's events flashed before my eyes. Listen. This is about yesterday, please don't. She interrupted me sharply. I don't know what came over me. It was all... just forget it. She stared at me. Honestly, much more confident than usual. Oh, if only it was that simple. There's nothing complicated about this. She sat down next to me. So close that I felt a bit awkward, but made no attempt to move away from her. Sometimes I just have disputes with Elisa. Yeah, I realized. I see. But in this case, it happened because of me. Who knows? She answered, lost in thought. So that's why, you know, I'm embarrassed. Perhaps I really am to blame. Or rather, I'm not trying to say that I'm not to blame, but... I'm trying to explain myself like a fifth grader to a teacher. Okay, don't. As I said, nothing serious happened. Well, if you think so. Just think about how to act from now on. Wait, what? Not again. I covered my face with my hands, clearly showing it had absolutely no idea what's going on here and that everything, to put it mildly, is very unpleasant for me. Can you please express yourself any clearer? What for? She said evasively. Look, if I don't know what I did wrong, I can't do any better. Like, I can't decide how to act, as you say. I think you'll understand. I would like to believe that as well, but... The canteen door suddenly flew open and Olga came out. Sitting around hungry this early, she said playfully. Good morning. Lena said merrily, and she got up and headed inside. Shall we? I guess, yeah. I heard a voice calling out to me. Semyon! It was Slavia. Busy? Nope. Can you help me then? Of course. I didn't want to look for answers on such a wonderful day like this. A couple dozen hours wouldn't change my situation after all. What is it? You should stop by the Cybernetics Club. I don't know why exactly, but they'll tell you everything, apparently. The unfortunate inventors again. All right. Thank you. She gave me a nice smile and ran off. So, a journey to the enemy's lair lies ahead of me. The lair of the evil Dr. Electronic and the diabolical Professor Shirk. Ah, oh, Semyon. Dr. Jekyll and Mr. Hyde. Which one is which? I pushed the door firmly in and entered. Semyon. Electronic said ominously, glancing up from some contraption he'd been poking with a screwdriver. Is it the cat lady robot again? And where is he poking that screwdriver? Don't do it, Electronic. It's forbidden. It's taboo. Slavia sent me. I know. And what? The second door opened, Shirk came in. Semyon. He greeted me in the same tone Electronic had. Well, I was last time I checked, I joked. So what do you need from me? We have an important task for you. I'm listening. The nurse came by yesterday. He stopped, as if he wasn't going to continue. And so? I asked carefully. So we have an important mission for you. I got that already. You are to deliver a package to her. Can't you do that yourself? The infirmary is right over there. I said skeptically. We can't. Electronic said, surprised. What a weird couple indeed. I see. Not another heavy bag, I hope. No, nothing like that. He smiled. All right, fine. I carefully agreed. Hold on. Shirk disappeared through the door and soon came back holding something wrapped in paper. Just be careful. All right. I looked in the package. I took the package. If the pioneers weren't passing me the key to the pearly gates, it still looked like they were at least giving me the Olympic torch. Can I go? Of course. Electronic said threateningly. What? Just be careful. Shirk pleaded. What is even happening? I took a good look at the package, never told me to not open it, although it makes sense to go further on. Quickly walked the square, slipped into the forest, stood there for a while, and decided looking at the package. I wonder, what's in it? So important for them. Why couldn't they just take it themselves? I had a lot of questions. I opened the package and saw a bottle of vodka. Well, so what? Pioneers bring a bottle of vodka to the nurse. Or rather, I'm doing it for them. Happens every day. I wrapped the bottle back up and scratched my head. Well, this isn't weird anymore. This is just stupid. So stupid I can think of an intelligent theory. I stood there for a while longer and thought I shouldn't let such a wonderful chance slip away. Quickly walked to the camp leader's cabin. Thank God, Olga was not there. Stuck inside and began to rifle through the contents of the table drawer. Soon the vodka was in the soda bottle, while in its place was some water for the plants. Wow, okay. Do you really want to get drunk that badly, Semyon? Happy with my clever plan, I went on and skipped along to the infirmary. Seriously, what's so wrong about that? Well, other than the fact that she might be using... Didn't she use the vodka as a, No, actually, didn't she have the vodka previously? And I had to take it? Now, whatever. They almost got me into a trap. The camp leader had sent me. If anyone else had, I could manage myself. It was absolutely nothing. I gathered all my strength and knocked on the infirmary door. Hello, Pioneer. Hello, I've packed for you a bottle for your armpit. I meant a package for your cabinet. Haha, I saw you fork, I began to talk nonsense. Ah, she said. Hand it over. I handed her the package. The nurse stuffed it into the desk drawer without looking. You didn't open it, did you? Of course not. I blurted out. Good boy. Alright, so I'll be Go-Go Pioneer. Okay, I closed the door behind me and let out a sigh. I could always pin this on the crazy inventors. In my situation, I could really use even the most basic form of stress relief. Oh, that's one way to justify it. Not sure it's a good one, but... Saul and I approaching. Relaxing? Something like that. She sat by me and looked at the sky. Nice day, huh? Well, actually, no, what Semyon was going on about how... Oh, it was never Trouble's fault. Or it was never his fault. It was always some other explanation for why all these bad things happened to him. Yet here he is, literally stealing vodka. Literally stealing vodka. Nice day, huh? It is. It was a bit awkward, Lena seemed different. She was not embarrassed, her face not red, she was confident. So, about that conversation. I told you everything already? Yeah, but... Just forget it. Fine, if you say so. Sat for a little while longer in silence. Oh, I just can't. Not like that. So what do you think about ALISA? She said, ignoring my inquiry. What do I think about ALISA? I'm guessing those two have talked. And ALISA now has some weird perception of reality that involves something weird. I repeated, lost in thought. I don't really know. Why? You're just so worried about yesterday. Well, of course. What does that have to do with it? There's a direct connection here. She laughed. Well, let's assume. So what? Well, she... So again, I started thinking. Oh, really, what do I think of her? Well, she's a bitch. Okay, let's call it arrogant. Yeah, that's a really nice way of saying it. She can be arrogant sometimes. That's right. What else can I say? I think of it, I don't know ALISA at all. The way she acts to, does annoy me sometimes. If you're wondering if I had any negative feelings for her, then no. Fucking bullshit, Semyon, fucking bullshit, you're lying. So many negative feelings right now. I mean, she gets carried away, but everyone has their quirks. Lena stared at me. Really? Did I say something wrong? No, not really. She laughed out loud one more time, before the lunch bell sound came. Huh, here's another theory, a solution to the problem of how I got here. Here is the explanation of what's going on here. And here's the true form of all things happening in this place. I remember Lena saying, what do you think of ALISA? Seriously, what do I think of her? What can I think of a person I've only had known for a few days? I can just draw conclusions based on a couple words and deeds. Although her deeds laughed a bit. Any relative organization would draw the right conclusion based on the monument bombing. Still, though, I don't care. Maybe I really don't think anything of her. I mean, I don't care that she's doing, like, the terrorist thing. Honestly, yeah, I don't. I mean, it's so inconsequential to me based on my situation that stuff is just like, I don't care. It's more the whole constantly threatening me. She's threatening me constantly. Constantly. She's just trying to do so many bad things to me, specifically. And she's constantly just trying to, do more than annoy me. Some sort of absurdity. Knock on the door. Come in. I was too lazy to get up, so I just sat a little bit. The door opened, I saw ALISA. Ah, look, she looks sad again. What a coincidence. She stopped, unsure, and stared at me for a couple of seconds. I guess you're looking for the camp leader. Why would she, though? No. What's up, then? I was looking for you. She sounded calm and not aggressive at all. I caught myself thinking I was not afraid and no concerns when she behaved like that normally. Honestly, yeah, I'm perfectly fine with her when she's not specifically trying to make my life just painful. What for? I want to make everything clear. She sat on the bed across from me. What exactly? I want to clear up any misunderstandings or miscommunications. Alright, I'm up for that. Have you spoken with Lena today? Yep. About what? Nothing really? You're lying. Lisa looked stiff and worried. She crossed her legs and bit her lip. You do understand, I was assumed to be guilty whenever anything happens. Well, you typically are guilty. Well, always, he said, but I said thoughtlessly. A spark flashed in her eye, but she kept talking calmly. Maybe. But in this case, me and Lena, we're always like that. Even if it's, she starts something, she's all innocent and I take all the blame. So you're saying that Lena... Actually, I don't really know what you're saying. You never understand anything, do you? Nope, I'm stupid, just deal with it. She fumed. This is strange, I wouldn't call myself slow. So explain. You do know that Lena likes you. She went red after those words. No, but I got that impression. I answered truthfully. Well, now you do. Now I do. An uncomfortable silence overtook the room. I was processing what she said, and Alisa seemed unsure of how to continue the conversation. Lena likes me. Could have I ever guessed? Ever. I mean, it's such a mind blow. I mean, who would have thought? I mean, Semyon, you only, like, speculated it earlier. Who would have thought? Unlikely. My intuition is usually good, but when it's about me and my feelings, it does not work at all. The weirdest thing is I accepted the news with almost no worries. Right at that same moment, I was listening to Alisa only focus on her. I could only think about the rest later. I think she's going to steal you, she thinks I'm going to steal you away from her. She thinks that all the time, understand? Even though it's always the other way around. Everyone looks at her like, looks at her because she's an angel. Nobody pays any attention to me. So then I'm just a shoulder to cry on. Alisa started screaming. Wait, look, wait, please don't get upset. I don't think of you like that. Of course. Yeah, I think of you as an extremely, a person who wants to do me constant harm in my life. That's what I think of you as. A mortal enemy who hates me. Well, probably doesn't hate me, but wants to cause me constant suffering out of love. That's a way to phrase it. Of course. I still had no idea what forced her to be so honest, and I didn't know how to react. Well, moreover, I was not worried at all. It was like I was watching an episode of some TV series. What was going on in the other side of the room was on the screen. I understand, but I understand that I was the reason for all of it. Today, Lena said it was okay. It's just like her. Probably realized that she's not as quiet as she wants to seem. I started to guess. If I can do anything. Tell me. She raised her eyes. Only then did I see that she was crying. Some sort of worry stirred up inside me. I cannot treat this conversation like it was an outsider anymore. Do you like Lena, or do you like me? I guess I should have expected a question like that, but I really wasn't ready. Well, honestly, in that way, neither of you? I guess. I haven't done Lena's route, so I haven't really had much reason to consider her, and you haven't done much to convince me. Lena's nice, of course, but Alisa has her good points as well. I'd argue that. Besides, the way she was at the moment, she could seriously compete with Lena. Well, I don't really know you two at all. A question like that, it's difficult to answer directly. If I could say no, I would have at that very moment. If only I had one chance for the other to answer as well. I don't know how to choose. You didn't want the situation to resolve itself. Of course, but... Why but again? Why again? Why? Look, we're going nowhere with this. Well, answer then. Her face was back to its usual bold arrogance. Just give me some time. Give me some time to think. Well, go ahead and think. Alisa stood up abruptly and headed out. Don't forget we have plans for tonight. Do we? Huh? Okay, fine, whatever. She sat on the threshold, smiling. The door closed behind her before I could say anything. Plans? What kind of plans? Well, the talk with Alisa left a heavy impression on me. So, Lena likes me. On its own, the news could be a shock and startling. And I, above that, was also forced to make a choice. A difficult one, to put it mildly. And any choice I would make would be a mistake for someone. Well, let's be realistic here, Semyon. You are not forced to say,
okay, these two people like me. I have to choose one of them and reciprocate that love. Because, let's be realistic, that's not how the world works. I mean, I probably have to in this situation because Semyon seems incredibly stupid sometimes, but yeah. If only I could refuse them both. Yes, you could do that. Why can't you? I didn't like the word refuse itself. If I could just answer her question with a no, it would be easier. But I knew it couldn't work like that. After I talked to Elisa, I realized nothing would ever be the same again. It can't be, no matter what happens. And I have to make a decision. So I rejected the no scenario. I need to pick a positive solution. If I could live with it. But I was sure that, out of all the possible outcomes, there's one that just won't satisfy everyone, but would also be one that I want to strive for. The choice seemed obvious, Lena. She's pretty, she's cute, she's kind. Then again, there's something about Elisa that attracted me. Whatever you say. Suddenly, the door flew open, Olga came in, ready to yell at me. Looking around, lounging around again, just resting. It's so hot out there. Go and help Slavia. She was asking around. Where? I asked lazily. On the sports field. Reluctantly, I got up and headed out. Okay, sure, whatever. Should really air my brain out anyways. You require my assistance, I asked, all official like. Yeah, listen, do you take the infirmary key? No. Did I in this one? I don't think I did. Why me again anyways? Well, you were there a lot recently. I guess she is right. Nope, I didn't. Maybe you know who did? No, why? The nurse came up and asked me for the key. You know that I have a key to every building in the camp. She said hers went missing. Could she have lost it? I shrugged. No, but she said she couldn't have. I don't know, okay? Okay. Oh, what the fuck did Elisa do? She smiled and ran off. Oh, crap. I don't know how long I would have stood there. My head was still heavy after sleep if someone hadn't called out to me. Slavia was there again. Semyon? She started, breathless. Are you sure you don't have the infirmary key? Oh, whoops. Wrong button. Of course not. Why would I need it? Well, do you know who took it? No, I don't. Why? Well, something has gone missing. What? Something important. Slavia hesitated. Some medication. So, all this disturbance was started because of some medicine? Although, I pondered. I mean, I have the bottle in my cabin. Does she mean that? I tried to keep my face still as stone, not doing anything to give myself away. Okay. I don't know, I'm sorry. Okay. Slavia said in frustration. I looked at her and tried to figure out how bad the situation was for me, whether I was in trouble at all. On one hand, the vodka, I did steal it. Then again, she's saying it's gone, hasn't disappeared, all by itself, with no external influence. Although it's highly unlikely that she would say a bottle of trophy vodka was stolen from the infirmary. So, the way it was said was okay. The problem was different. I suddenly got really scared. Oh, what if they found out it was me? What if it's about the bottle? They still find it while looking for what was gone. Basically, I had to get a move on. And the main thing to do right now is get rid of the evidence. No, why are you assuming it's the vodka? It could be anything. Or you could just fucking drink the vodka. Oh, that would be a fucking great way to get rid of the evidence. Just fucking chug the entire soda bottle's worth. Oh, you'd get in so much. You might die. I don't know. I'm not entirely sure how potent vodka is. I don't drink very often. I don't drink at all, but... But I do have friends who drink regularly, so I have learned quite a bit more about that over the past couple years. And yes, I am of legal drinking age, so don't worry about that. I jumped to the cabin, shoved the bottle in my belt, and raced to the forest. Burying it? How is that the best decision? Put it in a soda bottle. You can just dump it somewhere and then chuck the bottle somewhere. Just a fucking bottle. I took my time looking for a spot, never noticing night falling on the camp. Finally, a voice surprised me. Hey,
I struggle to turn back, making my face look as casual as possible. So, what's going on here?
Oh, I'm just having a walk.
My voice sounded so calm, but I understood. I couldn't fool Lisa. Alone at night in the woods?
Oh, yeah, what's wrong?
Nothing. Nothing at all. She stared at me.
Okay, then I'll...
Hold on. Aren't you forgetting something?
I don't think so.
We had an agreement.
About...
About tonight.
I think she's right. There was something like that.
Oh, yes, but you see...
No, I don't. Let's go.
She turned around and gestured me to follow. I thought there was no point in arguing. Any word or action give me away.
And then, sighing, I followed.
It was a couple of minutes before I reached her cabin. While we were walking, I was busy trying to find the best time to ditch the vodka.
Well,
she stared at me.
Well, what?
I was so nervous that my hair was wet with sweat. I think in my mind, I was willing to adjust the bottle so she wouldn't notice.
What did you say?
About what?
At least I pondered.
Okay, I guess you're right. I brought you here, so I'm the one to decide.
Okay.
I agreed, unsure.
Hold on a minute.
She reached under the bed, and in a few seconds, pulled out a bottle of vodka. I sort of kind of figured that she stole it. That has water inside it, too.
I was shocked.
Surprised, huh?
Of course.
Not by the vodka itself, though, but by the fact that the exact bottle I carried to the infirmary this morning. Murky contents gave it away.
So?
Alisa looked at me teasingly.
What?
Wanna take a shot? Fucking sure. Fucking sure. Why the fuck not? We're already pretty deep in it. I didn't even know what to say to that. What she had was rotten water. The real vodka was in the bottle under my belt. Well, she wouldn't know any better.
Well, I kind of...
Don't tell me that you don't drink. Alisa pouted. I don't know, no, I just... Alright then, just a second.
It was an instant that Alisa got two glasses and filled them up to the brim.
She has fucking shot glasses? Or did she actually just, like, get glasses and filled them up with vodka?
I'm pretty sure vodka is meant for shots, which would imply that it's pretty high proof, which means you wouldn't want to chug, like, an entire glass of it, because that would be really stupid.
Let's do this. She said, giving me one of the glasses and down hers before I could even answer.
Ah! She gasped.
In the moment she realized,
what on earth is that?
She started spitting.
Oh, have you drank regularly in the past, Alisa?
They call this vodka? Despite my difficulty, I couldn't help but laughing.
What are you laughing at?
Alisa shouted, red in the face.
I'm asking you, what's funny?
This is actually really funny.
So you're having fun. Drink yours, we'll see how you laugh then.
I had no desire to drink the stale water, but to avoid making suspicious, I asked,
so how does it taste?
Like rotten water. Alisa said, upset.
I was just about to relax a bit, had a little cultured time out, and then it...
A cultured time out.
I repeated as a new bout of laughter bent me in half.
Hey, stop it! Alisa shouted and jumped at me.
She was trying to hit me, or bite me or something. Maybe her plan was to crush me to death with her authority. I just grabbed her hands. All she could do was grasp in parlous anger.
It's all going fine, but then Alisa's leg slid and she began to fall.
And I let go of her hands, right on top of me, etc., etc., etc. Moan in pain, and this is probably in a very interesting situation.
What do we have here? When I realized she had taken the bottle, all the pain disappeared.
Wait, give that back.
I tried to get the bottle back, but Alisa jumped off the bed and ran to the far corner of the room.
Let's see, huh?
She immediately removed the cap and took a big gulp.
Don't.
In a moment, her face went red. Her eyes seemed to pop out of their sockets.
What is this?
She rasped while coming back to her senses.
That's the actual vodka.
She seemed to have come to terms with my defeat.
But where did you get it?
You really thought you had stolen the right one from the infirmary?
She nodded.
Well, it was the right bottle, sure, but the contents?
Man, you're clever.
She was already starting to slur her words.
Oh, great.
How cool. I mean, I guess it is vodka. I'll be right back. I want to check what proof vodka typically is.
Motherfucking 80 proof. Wow, that's quite significant.
to the window. Come on. I don't want it. Really, this is not the right time or place. Drink it, or I'll tell everyone you stole the bottle. But that was you. Well, you have the vodka. You can't prove that. I didn't steal the bottle, I stole the vodka. Think I even have to? She said maliciously. Unsure of what to do, I stared at the glass. What's important is to get rid of the vodka. It's just one of the ways to do it. Oh, yeah, this is just one of the ways to do it. I breathed out abruptly and swallowed the contents of the glass in one quick motion. A short moment later, I regretted that. God, any food to chase this? Wait a second. Lisa said excitedly and pulled a huge stick of ham out of the drawer. Why do you have that? I tore it from her hands and bit off a big piece. Phew. So, how was it? You're asking. It's not like I have full strength booze every day, you know? I didn't really understand how I'd agreed this so easily. Well, how was it? Like the boo with vodka flavor. Alright, time for another round then. She opened the bottle again, poured us half a glass each. Half a shot glass? Half a real, like a full, like normal drinking glass? I mean, that's a bit of a difference. 80 proof, remember, 80 freaking proof.
Don't you think that's enough?
No way.
Oh, since we've already started.
Alcohol was starting to work. Well, without a second thought, I gulped down the vodka. Lisa was definitely experienced. She's having some trouble with her second glass, though.
How is it?
She seemed really drunk already.
You can't take the heat, stay out of the kitchen.
I said merrily, pouring myself some more. Somewhere deep inside, I realized it was too much, but the gun was already loaded.
How about me?
Lisa was outraged.
Haven't you had enough?
No way! She grabbed the bottle from my hand and started to drink straight from it. No, hey, that's the worst idea. That's the bad I don't.
Hey, we have glasses, you know.
Screw him. This is like the perfect situation for getting caught. She shouted and roared in laughter.
This is so cool,
she said, catching her breath.
Sure, it's not bad.
I looked at the bottle. We'd gone through 2/3. I was definitely drunk by that point, and Lisa seemed even worse. Get some food in, you people. Then again, there was barely anything left. I sighed and poured a glass for myself and half for Alisa. I mean, I didn't even get dinner, did I? I didn't go to the canteen or anything. I've just been trying to hide this all afternoon and night. I've just been sleeping and shit.
That's all.
Those words, she chucked the bottle from the window.
What if they find it?
It's a soda bottle.
Oh, who cares?
We both laughed.
Okay, then.
For all ladies present, I grunted and drank.
And for the gentlemen.
She followed my lead.
I'm getting dizzy.
She undid a few buttons on her shirt and went to that look again.
Ah.
She seems to very randomly have that tied up look. I carefully looked at her.
Had she always been this beautiful?
Oh my goodness, you're drunk. Or is everyone beautiful to me at this point? Whichever it was, I could not force myself to look away.
You're gonna stare a hole through me if you keep going like that.
Alisa laughed.
Sorry.
Embarrassed, I stared at my feet.
You can look if you're so interested.
Some effort, I opened an eye and saw her continuing to unbutton her shirt. No words could escape my mouth. Besides, who needs words at a moment like this? What happened then was what was supposed to happen. A black screen. Everything went dark. So basically, Semyon blacked out. yeah, that is probably what was supposed to happen. At the time, I was unable to think what was the right thing to do. I didn't know, and I didn't want to. It just felt good. The light bulb burned out, or one of us turned off the light, but either way, the room went dark. Looked around her cabin and thought of something. So, where's Ilyana?
Oh, were you afraid someone would come and see us?
She grinned warmly.
Could happen.
I asked her to spend the night at another girl's cabin.
The fuck did she think of that?
My goodness, wait, so you planned on this? Well, not something like this, of course. She looked at me intently, smiled, and closed her eyes.
Yeah.
I stared at the ceiling for a while longer and soon heard quiet deep breathing. Alisa was asleep. My head ached suddenly. Yago seemed to be wearing off. Best thing to do in this case was to follow her lead and get some sleep as well.
But probably not in her cabin. That would be a bad idea.
That's the bad idea. I assume they, like, freaking went all the way, too. Before I finished the thought, I was already fast asleep. Great. Great. Fucking good job, Semyon. Fucking great job. Get fucking drunk, you fall asleep in her cabin. Who could imagine this going badly? Some people were chasing me, or maybe they wanted people, but fuzzy black bots and hellish landscape in the background. I ran, stumbling over something, having no air to breathe. My whole essence was overtaken by primal fear and terror. My memory lapsed. I opened my swollen eyelids for my eyes to be struck by bright daylight. A terrible taste in my mouth, pains all over my body, severe headache. Seems someone was drinking hard yesterday. It was probably me. After coming to my senses, I seem to recall the events of last night. Earlier there was a bottle of vodka, which I had emptied together with ALISA. I tried to stand up, but something was pinning my left arm. It was a peacefully snoring ALISA. Everything was happened to return to my mind. Fear was quickly replaced by a sense of euphoria. I relaxed lazily in the bed, enjoying a beautiful hungover morning. Well, sometime later, ALISA woke up. I kissed her softly and said, "Good morning." She gave me a blank look for a couple seconds and jumped up shouting, You? Me what? Yesterday you? No. Oh my goodness, don't you fucking dare. Don't you fucking dare, because last night actually made me think a little better of you. Fine, you stole it. Fine, you went drunk just like... You went drunk without even really thinking about it. But you weren't trying to freaking just make me miserable. She hissed. But it was kind of your idea. I was drunk. So was I. What can you do? ALISA was fiercely looking at me, but then calmed down and sat beside me. Alright, whatever happened, happened. You sure? I got up and tried to hug her. Don't. She whispered, blushing. Why? Because... ALISA frantically shook her head. Because it's 4 o'clock already. Wait, don't tell me you're late for something. Wait, it's 4 o'clock in the evening? Everyone will leave without us. Leave where? Today's the last day. Last day of... Wait, really? I asked completely confused. Last day of the term. Wait, what? The hangover seemed to have already passed a while ago and made a sharp comeback. Oh man, that would be bad. Don't tell me you didn't know. Asked ALISA in surprise. So you do know it? Well, yes, but I've forgotten it somehow. What should we do now? Actually, that wasn't the main thing I was concerned about. If today's the last day, then everyone will go somewhere. We can get out of this camp somehow. Well, I have no idea. Maybe we can still make it. I jumped out of the bed and started dressing quickly. Difficult as my coordination was badly disturbed by yesterday's lavish indulgence. What are you waiting for? ALISA didn't reply, but started dressing too. A couple minutes later, we're standing in the deserted square. Let's go to the camp leader's cabin. After opening Olga's cabin with my key, I found nobody inside. We checked the entire camp and found no one there. After returning to the square, I sat down and covered my face with my hands like a doomed man. I felt sick, but now it turned out that I had to solve a serious problem. Where would they have gone? Well, to the district center, I guess. Do you know where it is? Approximately. Is it possible to reach on foot? Don't know. How long would it take on bus? A couple of hours. Oh my goodness, that would take forever on... Quickly I reckoned how much that was in kilometers. Taking consideration the quality of Soviet motor car industry and the Soviet roads, one could presume it was quite possible to reach it on foot, but it would take goddamn probably take a day. Provided that ALISA knows the exact direction. Well, you are following roads. So yeah. Moreover, the situation is not easy to decide on such steps. We can't stay here either. Alone without... food in a deserted pioneer camp. In real life would definitely be a bad idea, and I had no other choice to treat everything happening as reality. Let's go. Where? To the district center. Are you mad? You prefer to stay here? Sure, they'll notice we're missing and we'll return. Don't you think it's odd that they didn't notice it during departure? Well, yeah, but... She started to think. But to go somewhere all on our own? But you said you knew the direction. I do. She agreed without confidence. So what's there to think about? Maybe we'll encounter some local buses along the way. I don't really believe that myself, but there is an exit from the camp that seems quite... If there is an exit from the camp, that seems like quite a solid idea. I don't know, as you say. She prattled on confusedly. Then start packing your stuff. Meet me here in a half an hour. Ran toward Olga's cabin. very clear she was the kind of person that she did not... She's not the kind of person she wants to seem like. What kind of person is the real ALISA? But do I have any feelings towards her? Do I feel sympathy, some sort of affection, or something more? My reflections were interrupted by ALISA. Here, take it. She held out a huge backpack to me. What's this? I asked skeptically. My stuff. Why so little? I brought as much as I could fit. We don't know how far we have to go. Maybe you could only take the necessary things, you know? So what, just throw it away, leave it here? Lisa sniffled. Firstly, I couldn't understand why she even has that much stuff, and secondly, what's so valuable in there? But in the chivalrous duty of carrying it is mine, isn't it? Of course. She smiled archly. I evaluated how much it would weigh. About 10 kilos, I guess. I can carry that for a few kilometers, but not much further than that. Do you understand that we're not going to get very far with that? Well, we'll do our best. That's so stupid. You mean I can throw something out later? We'll see. She answered with her eyes flashing slyly. Okay, taking you at your word. After all, as I have to carry it, I have the right to throw things out of it. So our journey begins. It took me at least an hour to start getting tired. I never thought I possessed such stamina. The backpack was easy to carry, or the nice exercise had trained my muscles. No, I think you train different muscles. I stopped on the roadside and threw Elise's belongings to the ground. What are you doing? She was clearly resentful. You want to carry it yourself? Of course not. In that case, I need to rest. Naturally, the most rational decision was to get rid of most of the stuff, keeping only the most necessary things, but I couldn't bring myself to such drastic measures. I've been keeping silent the whole time. Elise was staring vacantly down at the road that receded into the distance. What is there to talk about? I don't know. But you're behaving as if nothing happened. Did something happen? She asked absent-mindedly. Well, you know. Had enough rest? Then let's go. Elise began to quickly walk away from me. Hey, wait a minute. I shouldered the backpack, ran after her. We've been traveling silent for some time with ALISA slightly ahead of me and behind. And me behind. I had no idea how to start a conversation. She seemed to be giving out obvious hints that the night's events were one big mistake. At least it seemed like that to me. Though from my point of view, what happened was meant to happen. The last few days in the camp, I'd definitely been attracted to ALISA, apparently. And I believe she was attracted to me as well. In that case, what's the problem? Maybe she doesn't want to be a one-night stand? You know. She turned and looked at me. If I did something wrong... You did nothing wrong. This music. It's new. I don't think I've heard it before. It feels like something really bad's about to happen, though. But... It just turned out this way. So it's just an accident. I didn't say that. So what did you say? My inability to get a straight answer made me begin to lose my temper, and I raised my voice. Just giving me hints, ambiguities. What about straightforwardness, sincerity? You weren't like this before. People tend to change. She slowly paced forward. Change? You call this a change? You're a completely different person now, just like Lena, really. Ooh, Elisa stopped, but she didn't turn. Don't compare. Got it? Don't compare me with her. She spoke quietly, but the rage was in her voice. What? I was somewhat taken aback. Blame me for everything, but what about yourself? You're constantly looking at her. Even now you manage to see her in me. Wait, what? But I'm saying something negative about you in my comparison. Wait, what? No. No. What did you come... Why did you come that yesterday? You could have gone to her. You didn't know. Didn't know what? You didn't know that I was waiting for you. You seemed to be making this confession. It was a hard decision for ALISA, but at first I assigned a little significance to her words. You told me yourself to come yesterday, so I... This isn't about that. This person stopped and cut her face with her hands. I was completely taken aback. I still didn't get what she's hinting at, so it was impossible to talk normally. Sorry. Forgive me. Stop apologizing. But if I said or did something wrong... So what's the point in apologizing if you already did? Better behave yourself from the beginning. But I didn't know how. ALISA looked up at me. So much sorrow in her gaze, I couldn't bear it and turned away. We stood like that for some time. Soon she seemed to pull herself back together. Okay, forget it. Let's move on. Naturally, I couldn't just forget it if I wanted to. I had nothing more to say, so I followed her in silence. The sun was slowly moving behind the horizon. I was immersed in thoughts and even forgot about the heavy backpack on my back. I had to say something, do something. At least it was expecting me to. At least a few words. What should I begin with? Gotten used to everything in my life being quite simple. Any task to be already finished after only a few steps? Instead of considering the long way to my goal, I immediately started to think about the results, enjoying an unachieved victory. Moreover, I doubt I have to face a situation like this in the real world. Obviously, for a long time, I dreamed about a person who could care about me, but right now, such a person in front of me, and I feel nothing. I can't tell Elisa yes or no, just because I don't know what happened next. Meanwhile, it got dark. Okay, so we should make camp for the night. There's not that much left to go. Are you sure? Even if it's so, it's better to travel during the daytime. You know best, she answered coldly. Stop at the edge of a wood. Got anything useful in here? Point at the backpack. Have a look. Mainly footwear and clothes are in there, but at the bottom I found a magazine and a box of matches. Ah, quite enough to light a fire. Soon we were sitting in the fallen tree, warming our hands by a fire. So now I did finally realize that I finally got out of that damn camp. Found no answers, and on the contrary, everything seemed like it'd be even more tangled as. I guess I'm going to spend the rest of my life in this reality. Weird. But don't take consideration the sci-fi stuff. It's clear that there's somewhere in the south. We're somewhere in the south at the end of the 80s. And how, and more importantly, why I was brought here is not so important right now, as I have to somehow adapt first. I have to begin with the girl sitting by my side, so what we do when we reach the district center? Call her parents, what else? Elisa smiled slightly. She had someone to call. And then? Then it's all over. Meaning? Well, we'll leave for our homes. I wasn't really surprised by this answer, I just hadn't thought about what would happen after the term ended. And that's it. What else is there? I don't know. After all that happens... Nothing happened at all. She told me merrily. What do you mean nothing happened? You have a chance to find Lena. Surprised, but Elisa said it absolutely kindly. So if I need Lena, I wouldn't be so sure. Oh, I am sure. Let me decide for myself. Yeah? When did you start to do such silly things? So I remember my current age. 17 years ago. Yes, that's how old I am, right? Definitely. Well, admirable. But to be honest, I didn't notice anything like that. What exactly should you have noticed? That you were able to say something without a single doubt. She was absolutely right on this point. What exactly do you want to hear? You know what? This game of hints could last forever. If you want to know how I feel towards you, then I'll speak frankly. I don't know myself. That's exactly what I'm talking about. Elisa turned away. What can I do? That's the truth. What can I do? I don't ask anything of you. Yes? Are you sure? Sure. I answered after a while. What were you doing all 7 days in the camp? What was I doing? You were asking, weren't you? What was I asking for? For what I mean, can't you just talk in a way people can understand? The mind readers are on vacation. If you wanted to, you would understand. I can't understand something without an explanation. It's okay, just idle talk. She stood up and went towards the road. No way. I lost my temper completely, so I jumped up, ran up to her in a couple strides, grabbed her by the hand, and pulled her towards me. And threw her to the ground, apparently. I miscalculated the amount of strength I should use, and I found her below me. Yesterday wasn't enough. Want more? Her face was glowing, and her eyes were flashing. I really felt mixed up. I released the girl's hand, but I didn't stand up at once. I just want to understand. Where did I go wrong? What are you always thinking about, that you went wrong somewhere? Because you think so. Who told you that? I didn't. But you can see it. I can see it. You can see everything, don't you? You see and draw conclusions you shouldn't infer. They should lie low, say nothing. I draw conclusions based on logic. Are you sure that logic of yours is correct? I don't know what to say about that. For some time, we just lay there. Well, is Semyon really the person who should be telling the world how to interpret people's, emotions and stuff? I'm just saying. Just saying. I was completely confused. Frankly, she pushed me away and stood up. So, why are you here now, with me? Because everyone left at the camp and we stayed. I'm not not talking about that. Well, because I like you.
Finally, I dared to say it directly.
Are you sure?
What about Lena? She's always next to you.
No, she even wasn't. Especially not on this route. Maybe it's just she's too much work. What about me? I'm very simple. Just snap your fingers and I'm in your bed.
I mean, that's not a horrible trait to have in a girl.
I wouldn't say that simple with her. Oh, don't put words in my mouth. You say, so there's plenty of room there. But you think for, a dozen others.
Oh, she's absolutely right on that point.
I didn't think anything like that. So, do I have to just simply believe all of this?
You don't have to believe. I'm not forcing you.
But it's the truth. I'm not going to make up anything. Which should be proven with actions. What actions is she expecting from me?
Well, we could do it again.
Oh, I love you. How can I prove it? Let's have sex. I said with a stupid smile. I had no idea how I even dared to think of joking in such a situation, especially a joke like that.
Sure, come on.
Alisa said in a calm voice, walked to the fire and started to undress. I jumped up, ran to her, and grabbed her arm.
What are you doing? Wait, I didn't actually mean it.
Well, what's the big deal? Don't you need me just for that?
Of course not. You got me all wrong.
How should I get you then? She pulled her arm free and started crying. I lay down beside her, hugged her, and started patting her head. Everything is alright, calm down, leave me alone. She said through the tears, but didn't try to free herself. You see, I had a hard life before this camp. I just haven't gotten used to this. I don't know how to act in situations like this. I've been alone for a long time, no friends, no loved ones. I've forgotten how to feel and how to live. It's hard for me. So much easier not to get mixed up in those matters. Finally, it just became normal to not to. Here we are, something I never could have imagined. Does that mean that I'm an egotistical bastard? Although I guess it may seem to some people that maybe I am. I just can't do that right away. Lisa didn't reply and continued crying. But I know one thing for sure, there's nothing between me and Lena. She's a friend, nothing more. Never looked at her that way. And I need you, not only for what I think I want. What you think I want. I just don't know how to tell you things you want to hear. They carry obligations, you see. I'm kind of in a situation now where I don't even know what will happen to me in the next hour and here. Alisa seems not to be listening to me at all, or my excuses just didn't reach her. Well, I should be proud of myself. I made a girl cry, in which girl, Alisa, who at first glance seemed to be a complete stranger to any romantic feelings. You know, I can't make a decision for both of us. I can only say for myself that I'm ready to be with you, to support you, to protect you. But you? Why do you need me? I have nothing in my soul. I don't know what I want from life. Besides, I'm here now, and tomorrow I might be gone. Please stop crying for a moment. You understand that I already made my decision a long time ago?
Then?
She looked up at me with teary eyes. I might have seen happiness in them for a moment. Alisa embraced me tenderly and kissed me.
It was the best kiss of my entire life. Now, I wasn't so passionate one night, but there was so much tenderness, trust, and love that I dissolved in her lips, her arms.
I forgot about everything about the camp and about my past, which were tormenting me a moment before. She was all that I needed, now and forever.
And some sort of horn came by, I assume it's the bus, which makes it funny, because imagine if we actually went through with the sex. I guess imagine the honking in the middle of that going on. Oh my goodness, that would be hilarious.
Yep, and the horn sounds, I turned to the road and saw a bus. An old liaz, looked like a regular old one. We just lay and looked at it for some time. Soon the driver left the bus and shouted at us,
"Hey, lovebirds, this is the last bus in town, are you coming?"
"Shall we go?" Alisa said merrily. We jumped up, and grabbed the backpack, took Alisa by the hand, and ran to the bus. In a couple seconds, we made ourselves comfortable on the back seat. The driver was shouting something from his place, but I didn't listen to him. Here it is, we're actually ship, headed for a new life. Look at Alisa, so eager to say something to the conversation by the fire. She's sleeping peacefully, resting her shoulder, her head on my shoulder. I don't wake her up, there's no need to. We have so much time ahead of us. There's no one in the bus except us. The bus is going fast, leaving my previous life, etc., etc., 7 days, leaving that real life. How much of it was still lying ahead in the future? The calm country scenery in the window didn't interest me much. I was just watching Alisa peacefully sleep. My heart was filled with warmth and calmness, and my head finally stopped bursting with thoughts. But happiness is a fragile matter. Many things are destroyed. Time, for example. The longer your happiness lasts, the more common it becomes. Emotions stall. New problems and worries appear. Felt good, but the accumulated exhaustion didn't let me enjoy the moment. I fell asleep. Seems I'm getting old. The day was over and the hangover should have been long gone, but I still felt sick and dizzy. Despite how hard I tried, I was unable to open my eyes. I just rolled over. And what awaits me in this district center? How am I to live? It's not that... Oh, well, sure. I don't know where to begin, but on the other hand, I don't... This world doesn't seem to very hostile. I know a lot of things here. Everyone speaks Russian. So, maybe nothing bad is going to happen? Suddenly, I felt very sick. Damn it, I thought it was all gone from yesterday evening. And I'm back here. Yep. Reached the toilet, moving instinctually. For some time, my dirty business was done. I returned to the room, and I figured out that I was back here. Yep. Time passed. The events that took place in camp seem more like a fascinating novel I once read. No, I haven't forgotten them. I could recall them in the finest detail. I remember how, as a child, I used to lie under a blanket with a flashlight and read a fascinating book about space and spaceflight until dawn. Sometimes I was unable to get up to go to school. My parents always used to scold me for that. But with every night approaching, I would carefully turn every page, trying to absorb every minor detail of the story. I had similar feelings about the Pioneer Camp. Reality, if it can be considered as such, now seemed like more like the book. I didn't think it was all that bad. In the end, the main thing to remember is not, and it is not important whether these memories take form of the slideshow, photo, video, audio. Now, each bus made me feel both fear and hope. At first, I first circled around the 410 without purpose. Several times, I fell asleep on the same seat. But nothing happened, not even a trace of something supernatural. As times went by, I stopped these idle trips. Something changed my life, I just couldn't do otherwise. A couple of weeks after my return from the camp, I took my guitar, I was lying lonely and gathering some dust in the corner. Struck a couple of chords, I remembered Lisa, for her image was inseparable from the instrument. At first, that didn't work out very well, I'd maybe just say no musical talented, talent for music. Just started teach yourself books and watching video lessons. On the other hand, all the effort wasn't a burden anymore. I just played the chords and polished my skill. And as it is with any kind of activity, including music, practice makes perfect. But half a year later, I realized that I achieved some results. At least I could now smoothly play parts of my favorite songs. Satisfied with my progress, I put a couple advertisements on music forums, tending to form my own band. I still had no idea what kind of music I wanted to play. My taste varied from something really heavy to anime soundtracks. At first, it seemed impossible for me. I would have to communicate with strangers, and what if we were just too different? Anyways, how do I explain to others what music I wanted to make? It all worked out much easier. Potential candidates turned out not to be so frightening. Our tastes were mostly the same. After all, we shared the same goals, so issues stemming from a lack of understanding could be resolved. And soon, we had a band. Suddenly, I discovered my talent as a composer. Having spent entire days and nights on the note editor and sequencers, I started composing okay-ish things, at least in the opinions of other band members and pals I showed my songs to. Quite soon, we gave our first concert. A D-list club not significantly more spacious than my bedroom, 3.5 viewers who weren't exactly sober, and a hellishly anxious, I was hellishly anxious and the sound equipment was constantly malfunctioning, but all that didn't bother me because I was happy, since this was just the first step to success. However, it was a long time before we were invited again. With great difficulty, we managed to record 3 tracks and publish them on the internet. The reviews were far from ecstatic, but it didn't bother me so much. It was just a beginning. Maybe some considered our music just a leisure activity or a brief fixation, but for me it was serious. After all, it was me who founded the band, and all the music was mine as well. I felt a personal responsibility for the fate of my creation. Every moment I spent improving on my performance technique, and after a year I could already confidently say that I wasn't the worst guitarist in the world. Then some form of popularity came. We were giving the concert almost every week and finally getting paid. It wasn't important, it was just like 500 rubles per man, but the fact that our work was in demand and someone was ready to pay us for it, even though we were usually a warm-up from some other band, was what mattered. I was sitting in my before my monitor, torturing guitar. The date of an upcoming concert was thickly circled in my computer desktop calendar. The very thought of that gave me goosebumps. It would be the first time we would be headliners. We'll have an album presentation as well. Probably disc would be sold. Of course, the CD era is already over. But there are some who still appreciate it. But some will buy it just to support the band. I looked at the date once more. Yes, it's exactly a year since I returned from Sovionok. My smile reflects the darkened monitor screen. I wonder whether ALISA would like my music if she exists in this world. No, she'd probably just freaking hate it. She'd tell me how horrible it is, etc., etc. Just joking. I don't think so. She preferred Soviet rock classics, but who knows? I played a couple complicated guitar parts and concluded with a feeling of satisfaction the sound of my guitar surpasses by far that of the Soviet Earl guitars, and that my skills overcome that of the guitarists of the same era. I wonder whether I would have achieved all this without those fantastic events. Unlikely. Nothing strange about it, lots of people rethink their life after stepping close to the edge. Sure, nothing dangerous happened back there, but a psychological shock is a good substitute for grave danger. I rehearsed my part once more, put my guitar into a case, packed all my stuff, and headed to the exit. It's cold outside just like that day, so they approached the bus at 4:10. Such a coincidence, I'm going to this club on the very same bus. With a sinking heart, I counted down the seconds. Soon the bus opened. It arrived. It idly opened its door and swallowed a few passengers. This was a night just like back then. Cars flashed by outside, their headlights igniting the city as I got ready to sleep. The closer we got downtown, the more people were in the streets. Some of them were chanting merrily. Some were perusing magnificent boutique windows. Some were hurrying somewhere, paying no attention to anything. This day, I had no wish to return to the camp. Any other time, maybe, but not today. I must play the concert. The rest can go to hell. I had a clear aim and nothing else mattered. And then I fell asleep and went back to the camp. The club was considerably larger than the... was considerably bigger than the one we played our first concert in, but at the moment it was empty. The soundtrack was going on. I couldn't hear the drums through the monitor loudspeakers, which I desperately tried to get the sound tell the sound guy about. Sound tuned, gadgets installed, set list all prepared, ready to rock. But it was a special day. We were not doing the warm-up. The other guys were doing the warm-up before our concert. Thus, our entrance is last. As I listened to the first band, I know that they have a lot of improving to do. On the other hand, we were not better so long ago. Not so long ago. As time got closer to the start of our performance, my tension grew enormous. Come on, I was literally shaking with anxiety. I decided not to listen to the other band and wait calmly in the dressing room. Judging by the expressions, my mates were in the same mood. We were silent. Actually, we had nothing to talk about. Our parts were learned and perfected a long time ago. Our nervousness could only hinder us. But we already have some experience, so everything will be fine. At least I comforted myself with this thought. Now finally the time has come. I don't remember how we entered the stage and greeted the audience. My consciousness turned when the first chord of our first song came on the speaker. While sitting in the makeup room, I desperately tried to warm my ice-cold fingers, but now they ran from string to string without the slightest mistake, as if they were charmed. Well, if this is the song that they're playing... not bad, not bad. A thought flashed across my eyes. Why did I make a single mistake? When I played all these parts at home during rehearsals, I never thought about it. Everything seemed a matter of course. But now, when I stood in front of the audience, it felt so different. Somewhere deep inside my mind was the thought that soon my finger would slip and, thank goodness, the thing didn't interfere with my playing. Our performance was nearing the end, now it's time for the difficult solo I had been learning for so long. By that point, my nervousness had vanished, and I played through it perfectly, even better than during rehearsals. Finally, our performance was over, and the concert hall burst with applause. I smiled awkwardly, or at least I thought so, and bowed several times with the rest of the bands. They shouted encore to us. Even without them shouting, I would have been glad to play something else, but we'd run out of songs if we were just a newly formed band. Euphoria prevailed in the dressing room. As we congratulated and hugged each other, the sound of the opening champagne bottles echoed in the halls. All their discs had been sold, which made me even happier. Oh, they're getting really popular, eh? Finally, I managed to become something too. It's impossible to predict the future of our band or the whole affair with music. One thing was clear, I finally found something I'm interested in and can dedicate my entire life to. As well as that, I can see that it may be able to make other people happy with me as well. I was probably now the happiest man on earth. At least, it was surely the best moment of my life. Club is empty, instruments are packed, and I'm waiting for the others so we can go home. And here comes the typical ALISA. Or typical, they show up in real life thing. Hey! I turned around and saw a girl standing nearby. Her tone wasn't too polite, but it wasn't hostile either. I liked your performance. Thanks.
The darkness of the club prevented me from clearly seeing her face, but I was sure it was extremely familiar. And you? I stepped forward. Exactly. It was ALISA. Frozen spot, unable to speak. What about me? Nothing. I just thought I'd seen you somewhere before. So I had to jump at her with questions about a pioneer camp. After all, it's possible that this girl merely looks like her. Or something like that. Anyway, it's obvious she was seeing me for the first time. Or at least was pretending to. Well, generally it's true. She peered. My name's Semyon. Forcing an artificial smile, I offered her my hands. I actually know that already. How? Read it on the internet. Oh, right, of course, I'm a band, so I'm sort of kind of a celebrity, a very small-time one. And you are? ALISA. She replied somewhat confusedly. So I was right. But how right was I? Listen, do you ever go to Pioneer Camp as a child? No. Why are you asking? Oh, she's lying. She always freaking lies. Just... seemed like that I met you there. How could you have met me there if I'd never been there? She laughed. Yes, all of you musicians are somehow strange. No doubt. Well, I just wanted to say that your music is not too bad. ALISA turned to leave. I felt that I need to do something, say something. Oh, come to our next concert? When? To be honest, I had no idea myself. Soon, probably. Yes, maybe. Send me a message. Yeah, sure. We shared contact details with each other. Then I'll see you again, probably. She waved her hand and went out. Obviously, I had no idea if she had the very same. She was the very same ALISA I met in the camp. Any number of theories were nullified by my absolute absence of facts. At that moment, it was the last thing that concerned me. I was filled with emotions both from the concert and meeting ALISA. After all, nothing's preventing me from calling her, and then we'll see. I smiled, showed my guitar, and started to walk out the fort. Walk to the 410 with my mates. Up guru. every story has blah 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 blah. Okay, so that was ALISA's you know, Oyana's ending actually made me sort of sympathetic towards her. Still don't care for that much her that much as a character, but the ending did a good job of making me not hate her in any way or form for the annoyances she brought up to me. ALISA, honestly, I guess the very ending, all that other stuff that happened at the end, wasn't so bad. She's just very obstinate. No, maybe that's not the right word, but I don't know. I don't think she did anything to make up for the things that I really don't like about her. And she didn't really, like, go away from that too heavily. I don't know. I know some people, of course, are going to like different characters more and some characters less, but in my case, I found a specific character ending that seems to strike me as the one I dislike the most. Of course, I haven't done Lena, but I don't know. It would be hard to beat, especially considering I sort of think Lena's fine. Okay. She's actually a pretty decent character. But yeah, that was ALISA's ending. I'm going to do Lena's good and bad ending next as a video, and then after that, the true ending equivalent. So, that has been Echo 6 here with Everlasting Summer. See you next time. Drive safely.